know, the guests just keep getting better and better. Who books this goddamn show anyway? I got to tell you.
This is the most comprehensive look at the show that you're ever going to find anywhere.
Absolutely.
We have in front of the camera, behind the camera, before the camera, everything. We got it. We have a really well-rounded group of people.
Well, at the beginning, we said we want everyone who made this show great. It's the greatest show in TV history, if not one of them, but arguably the best show in TV history. And it wasn't just the actors that made it great. It was the directors and writers and camera guys and cinematographers and location and even a teamster or two made this show great.
It was a team, without a doubt.
It really was. And today we've got a cinematographer. And he directed an episode. I believe it was his first episode directing anything. He worked on all six seasons of The Sopranos, even though it really was seven seasons. Camera operator. Cinematographer. He directed. He was nominated for 8 Emmy Awards, 4 for Outstanding Cinematography for The Sopranos. He won one for Mad Men. Outstanding Cinematography, nominated for 2 Emmys for Outstanding Directing for Mad Men. He also directed episodes of 41 different TV series: Breaking Bad, Mad Men, Sons of Anarchy, The Walking Dead, Ozark, Orange is the New Black, etc., etc., etc.
Best TV shows around. That's it. He's
really
doing the best.
Good guy. Yeah. He got along. He was one of us. I know Jim loved him. We all did. We had a lot of fun. Always. I never saw him in a bad mood. Maybe you did. I never did. Seems always.
I've never seen
you
in a bad mood either.
Yeah. Well, you're being sarcastic because you're a fucking yo-yo and you like to break my balls.
You find it very out of the ordinary that someone's never in a bad mood. That's remarkable.
Yes. Of course, I'm in a bad mood most of the time, I'll be honest. But I love Phil Abraham, and let's bring him on. He's a terrific guy, and I'm really looking forward to talking to Phil Abraham. There he is.
Hey, guys. How are you?
What's up, buddy?
That was very good.
That was quite an introduction. I didn't know that I had worked on 41 different shows. That's insane.
Listen,
directed. That's
crazy.
We're
a plethora of information here.
Yes, I know.
That's what we do, Phil. That's what we do.
I'm getting that. Hey, I wanted to tell you guys one thing. So, you know, you called me to come on to this, and I thought it was great. And then I started sort of looking at a few episodes, and I was at Mickey Mantle Day 2.
Oh, wow.
No way. You got, really?
Yes. Yes. Wow. I mean,
1969.
You pulled that up, and I'm like, I was there.
Wow.
So,
now, how old are you, Phil?
I am 61.
Okay. I was the oldest of the group. That's amazing. That is amazing.
I was 3 years old. So you you must have been
like
10.
I was like 9. Yeah, 9 or 10. Yeah.
I was 11.
Yeah,
I was 11.
There you go.
Wow.
We were all
there.
There
you go. Look at that.
I have the pennant. I said it on the show. I have the pennant from that day. We still have it.
That brochure that you showed, I had that forever. And I, like, when you pulled it out, I'm like, wait, that's really familiar. And then I started looking at it and it was like, whoa. And I don't know where mine is, but I'm sure I have it somewhere.
That's amazing. You know, for the people that don't know, so I brought out, I had Mrs. Babe Ruth's autograph, and I showed it on the show, and it was Mickey Mantle Day, I forget the date, was it in June? June of 69. I showed it. Michael realized he was there, and now Phil Abraham, he was there. So who knows how many other Soprano family members were there that day.
Yeah, interesting.
I thought that was cool.
That is really something. How you been,
man?
So
you grew up in New York? Were you from New York originally?
Yeah, city boy. Yeah.
From New York City.
Manhattan, Upper West Side, Upper East Side.
Hey, Phil, I'm not lying. You're going to think I'm bullshitting you. You look exactly the same, I swear to God. And I saw you, I don't know, I ran into you in the street at some point.
Yeah, a few years ago.
Yeah, a few years ago. But you look exactly the same, man. I mean, really. And yeah, now you're on to big things. You're doing your first episode that you ever directed, right? Of a TV show was The Sopranos, correct?
Correct.
And
yeah,
that's a big deal because you were in. It was the last nine. You directed. What was the name of the episode? Does anyone know? Andy, find out. I knew
was
it.
Nobody knows anything. No.
No. It was. Remember when?
That's right.
A big deal. I mean, you started out as a cameraman on the show.
Started out as so I was the B camera operator on the pilot.
B camera operator.
B camera. And
so
then,
tell the audience what that is, because our audience, not all of them knows. Yeah.
Well, so a camera operator is the person physically behind the camera with their eye to the eyepiece, and they're moving the camera and operating it. And the cinematographer, the director of photography, is his boss, essentially, and working with the director and lining up and designing the shots and things like that. So the B camera operator is essentially the second camera. But The Sopranos was not full-time B camera. So, right. You know, they called B camera in when they knew they needed a second camera.
So Phil, you went to school, did you know you always wanted to do this?
You know, in some weird way, I think I knew I always wanted to do this. I mean, and it didn't come from any connection or anything like that. It's like I'm a New Yorker. You know, the idea of working in the film business is about as foreign as anything. Like it was unusual, but I was just a huge movie fan, like from a very, very early age. I mean, I remember both my parents worked. I'd come home. I mean, I was very young. I mean, I would be coming home from school alone in the first grade. You know, it's like you think about doing that now, but you know, you get the key, you come in, and the 4:30 movie and the $1 million movie and all
million
these,
dollar
like,
movie channel 9
oh my know. God, channel 9 and all these movies, I was just like addicted to them, and I knew all these movies, like, you know, I just soaked them up. So the idea of, like, I mean, it's something I was always really interested in, so yeah, I wanted to do it. I didn't know how.
Did you go to film school?
I went to Wesleyan in Connecticut, and I was a film. I was a art history major, but I was like a de facto film major too. I mean, I took all the film classes, and I shot a couple of student films there, and that's what really kind of gave me the bug for shooting. I mean, I was into photography. I had a little darkroom set up in my bathroom as a kid. You know, I did all that stuff, but I wasn't. I think it was that Wesleyan sort of experience of shooting the show that really gave me the desire to do that, you know?
What was your first professional job?
First professional job. So right out of school, a friend of mine who had graduated the year earlier from school had a staff PA job at Jenkins Covington Newman, which was a small commercial production house in New York City over on the East 70s by the East River. And they had their own stages, little stages, and one of these old sort of carriage houses that used to house, you know, right, horses. And they had their own Panaflex. So they had their in-house Panaflex on lease to them because they were always working. And so every assistant cameraman who came to check out would come to Jenkins Covington to check out their camera package. So it was sort of in that early stage, like right out of school, that I also sort of met assistant cameramen and started to help them and learn the system and learn the camera. And it was great, actually.
And how do you wind up on The Sopranos? How'd that happen? You went out for an interview, and do you remember?
I don't know exactly how I got the call to be the B camera operator. I think the way I'm going to remember this is that Gerard Sava was the assistant cameraman on the pilot and on the first season. And I think, you know, Alex Sokurov was the original director of photography. And I think he probably told Gerard, I need a B camera on these days. And he may not have had someone specific in mind. And Gerard and I were friends. And he said, are you free on these days? And great. And then I think Alec liked me, and I liked Alec. And when it went to series, he asked me if I'd do it.
So, and Alec, you guys switched on and off the whole rest of the way, right?
At some point. So what happened is, so in the first season, Alec was the single cameraman, single alone, you know, so he would not have the benefit of prepping. Directors would prep on their own. Alec was shooting every show.
He was the DP, cinematographer.
He was the DP. He was the cinematographer. He left mid-season, and then they bumped me up to DP halfway through the first season, which was an incredible opportunity. You know, it would never have It's funny because I remember Kevin Janicelli, the gaffer, would give me, you know, when Alec knew he was leaving and they knew I wanted to do it. And Kevin was always telling me, your stock is up today. And like the next day he'd come in, I'm not so sure. They're calling these other guys. But I think, honestly, I think they couldn't find anyone else, if you can believe it. I mean, I think David was sort of, we were only like five or six shows in. So how well did he know? You know what I mean? But I had some shooting experience. I had actually shot an independent film with Edie Falco. So I think David
saw it.
And it was called Trouble on the Corner with Tony Goldwyn, Edie Falco. What a cast. Tony Goldwyn, Edie Falco, Charles Bush, Tammy Grimes, Debbie Mazar, Giancarlo Esposito. I mean, really good cast. Joe Morton. I mean, like a crazy cast.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a cool little movie. And they hired me.
So Phil, you basically maybe have seen every single shot of The Sopranos. All 86 episodes, you were there.
No, because what happened was Alec came back in season three.
You were switching on and off.
Then we'd alternate because, you know, the value of prepping with the director was huge, especially as the show grew bigger and more complicated. And it was such a location-based show that it was really kind of imperative. You know, you pick locations, and then for some reason it was like a night interior. It was a day interior, but you knew it was going to go into night. You just had to be aware of all the technical aspects of things that you were getting yourself into and why some places could work better than others. And it was a good move, you know, to do it. And also, honestly, shooting every episode, the hours we did. It was just burnout time. So yeah. It was great.
16 hour days, right?
It's funny because I took the job season one as the operator, and literally maybe 2 days after I said yes to the job, I got a call for a movie because, you know, you have to understand New York was not a TV town. New York was a movie town. And like the crews worked on movies. We didn't work on TV shows.
Right.
And I got a call to operate on this Wes Craven movie that Peter Deming was shooting. And he called me and I go, oh man, I just took a TV show. And it's like, oh, really? You sure? It's like, you know, well, you know, I was expecting we were having our second kid. And Eileen, our producer, said, look, you know, you need to take an episode off, have the baby, come on back to work. You can never do that on a movie. So I took the show. I stayed with The Sopranos. And I remember our first week at work, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18 hours, days. I mean, that was our first week. And I called Peter Deming and I said, is that job still open? And it's like, no. And it's like, oh man, thank God. Right. Like, I mean, I don't think I was going to bail, but it was sort of like, it was an eye opener. That was intense.
So you had mostly done film before The Sopranos, more like independent or big budget or both or what?
No, big budget movies. You know, I was an assistant cameraman for many, many years, and I worked with like all the great cameramen. And I was an operator only for a few years, truthfully, thanks to The Sopranos, really, because they sort of accelerated my move to shooting, which was great.
What are some of the movies that you did? back then, before?
Well, I was a camera assistant on The Witches of Eastwick. Extreme Measures with Gene Hackman and Sarah Jessica Parker and Hugh Grant. You know, I did a couple of Gordon Willis movies, sort of day playing.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Gordon Willis shot The Godfather. Yeah, he did The Godfather.
I worked with Gordon. Scotty Rathner was Gordon's main assistant, and he was always working. So he got me to do all the testing with Gordon. And Gordon would come in and, like, test cameras. And I mean, like, he would prep for a movie for a month, and we'd go out and shoot literally shots for the movie. That it was really kind of an interesting, it was great. It was a great experience.
He did both Godfather 1 and 2, right? Did he do both of those?
And 3.
And 3 as well? Wow.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure he did 3, yeah.
Phil, so, I mean, you saw a lot, right? And I remember, I think it was at one of, premieres, and you told me that Jim would question you, like, you know, you would say, hey, have you heard anything? Like, Jim was afraid of getting killed off the show. And I remember you telling me something like that, that Jim had come to you. Hey, how you hear anything about David? You hear? Am I doing okay?
I don't think he was concerned about being killed. I think, you know, Jim and I had a really very,
you guys were close.
Very close relationship. Yes. And I think he kind of suffered a little bit of, like, never getting any feedback. Like, I guess, you know, David is, I don't know if David ever felt the need to come down and say, Jim, you know, you're just killing it. You're just, it's incredible. You know,
that didn't happen that much. No,
it didn't happen. I mean, and nor did we all, I certainly never expected anything like that to happen, you know, but I think Jim was feeling like, you know, it'd be nice to hear that from someone.
Pat on,
like,
the back once in a while. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's not to say, you know, I mean, Jim knew what he was doing, you know. But I do remember one thing with Jim early on with the director, where we were shooting a scene. And at the end of it, you know, director says, okay, cut, print, let's move on. And Jim, like, says, Phil, come here. And we walk, he pulls me off to the side. And I remember, and I, you know, this is in front, before we're moving on, he's pulling me off behind the stage to talk to me. And he goes, listen, I need you to keep an eye on me because I just tanked that last shot, like, to see if this guy knew what he was doing. And he just printed it and moved on. Wow. So I'm like, whoa, okay, yeah. So, I mean, I think Jim was, that was still like in the first season. So things were, we had a lot of different directors come through. I mean, like the first season, there was, like, you know, a different director on every episode. You know, I think maybe Alan and Tim Van Patten did 2 or something, but not too many repeats on the first season.
And he trusted your judgment. I know you guys were really close. And I'm sure besides myself, Jim was your second favorite actor. And I know that.
I don't, if you know it, I don't need to comment on that.
You don't need to comment, no.
I mean, especially first season, Steve.
Especially in the first season. Steve was brilliant in the first season.
Yes.
Yeah.
What the fuck, Phil? You saw the best and the worst of
all of us.
What went on? I mean, honestly, you saw the best and the worst. I mean, you saw a lot. I mean, right? I mean, you're looking at it through different eyes, kind of. I mean, listen, we're working 18 hours a day. Yes, it was a family. We all got along, but, you know how it goes.
Yeah. I mean, look, you know, as we've all been saying, it was the experience of a lifetime, truthfully. And the family aspect of it, I think, you know, made it all the more special, especially, you know, after season 2 going forward, you know, how unusual it is for the same crew to stay together on a show over the course of its life. You know, it doesn't happen. You know, people move on, they get other opportunities. But there was something about, as hard as the work was, there was something about this group of people that gelled in a way that was, I've never seen anything like it before. And as you say, I've been on a lot of shows subsequently, but you just don't see a crew that is, you know, that is that tight knit. And even when we had issues with each other and there was a tremendous amount of ball busting and we were as dysfunctional as you could possibly be, there was this sort of bigger sense of camaraderie and purpose that really held us together, which I think we all felt. We all felt that.
100%. What do you think the from like a DP or like a cinematographer's point of view, what did The Sopranos do differently? What ground did it break as a TV show?
Well, so interestingly, you know, that's a great question because like I never worked in TV before, you know, and I think that was a lot. And, you know, I think Alec had done television work, but was mostly an independent movie guy. And and David
so
was certainly,
I.
Yeah. yeah. And David Chase was certainly a huge cinephile and just berated network television, you know, it was never so. So knowing that, and like David had references to movies that we talk about, and just knowing that there was no sense that we had to prescribe to a certain rules and dictum of making the show in terms of like, you must get a close up, you must get this, you must get that. No, you know, I mean, quite the contrary, you know, so we were shooting the show with no constraint to just make it the very best it could be visually and as cinematographic as it could be. So, right. So I think the fact that we really weren't trained by regular television standards sort of helped everybody. And the crew was all movie guys. I mean, you know, like I said, New York was not a TV town. It was a movie town.
No. No, I made my living mostly doing independent movies and the occasional big Hollywood movie once in a while, but mostly, yeah. And the actors as well. I mean, David really was the one who had most of the TV experience, if you think about it. I mean,
yeah, 100%. Probably David and the writers were television and the guys, but the crew wasn't at all. So I think, you know, looking back on it, maybe that had something to do with it because we didn't really necessarily the standard norms were not ingrained in any of us, you know?
Right.
And you know, there was the idea of, you know, this wide shots that we used to do, you know, and no one
and long
that.
Takes
and long takes. Takes.
Yeah.
Very long takes. So that was different.
Yeah. Without
Phil,
a doubt.
Phil,
it shows.
When you finally got your chance to direct, okay?
Yeah.
Were you a nervous wreck?
Oh,
were you confident? Even though you knew everyone, so you had it easier than a director that comes in off the street, which there were, come in, Mike Figgis, I remember, Bogdanovich, just to name a few that came out of nowhere and did one or a couple, and you knew everyone, makes it a little better. You knew the crew. You knew the actors. You were a beloved guy. You still were nervous?
Yeah, because you're nervous because you'd never done this before. I mean, as you say, you know, the crew, the cast, everyone was like going out of their way to support me. So, you know, it's sort of like an ideal situation. It was incredible. You know, when it was all done, I can't say that I was like, oh, man, I loved it. And honestly, I'll be honest, directing was never something that I was like passionate about. It wasn't the thing that I really wanted to do. I was doing what I really wanted to do. I wanted to be a cameraman. I wanted to shoot big movies. That's what I really wanted to do. And honestly, I just had a sense that maybe if I directed an episode, I could become a better cameraman, truthfully. Just sort of stepping in those shoes would sort of help me, kind of see the other side of it and know the pressures and the constraints. So like when I took more time lighting a scene, I know what's the, he's like, you know, the director's pulling his hair out. I could sort of, I could sort of live that.
Wow.
And when I did it, honestly, it was not love. It wasn't instant love. You know, I'm really glad I did it, but it wasn't like, oh man, I cannot wait to get back in the saddle and do that again. I was happy I did it. I was grateful for David for giving me the opportunity, and it was great. But then truthfully, when I moved to Mad Men and Matt Weiner gave me a second opportunity to shoot an episode on Mad Men, that was something that actually, there was something there that made me think, it was interesting. And I'm not sure what it was, maybe because it was a new show and maybe because I didn't know everyone that well, you know, mm-hmm. there maybe after all those years of familiarity, who knows? I'm not sure if that had anything to do with it, or if it was just the show. But I think after I did that episode of Mad Men, I started feeling like, I could do this. I really enjoyed it.
And you moved into directing after that full time. You don't DP anymore, or is it just exclusively directing now?
Yeah, I haven't shot anything since the last thing I shot was a movie with Chris Columbus in 2008. So we shot the Mad Men pilot in between our two seasons, our last 6A, 6B of Sopranos.
Yeah.
And then Matt moved the show to LA because he lived in Los Angeles. And it was after the second season of Mad Men where all of a sudden it just sort of exploded and I started getting 100 calls. So.
And do you enjoy the casting process? I mean, do you enjoy actors, Phil? I mean,
yeah,
I know some. Listen, some directors don't. We know some that don't really like actors. We know casting people that don't really like actors. They're frustrated actors. Do you enjoy actors?
I mean, honestly, that's sort of my joy of directing is working with actors now. It's funny enough, but I love actors. And interestingly, when I've worked with actors who direct, they hate actors. It's really kind of interesting, you know, mm-hmm. but I come from it from the other side. And I think truthfully, you know, a lot of it had to do with my experience on The Sopranos, working with you guys, working with Jim. I mean, there was, you know, there's something there that is, you know, it was just very special. So I love working with actors and casting, you know, casting has changed, as I'm sure you guys know, that people hardly ever cast in the room anymore. And, you know, to me, that was all the fun of casting, where, you know, an actor comes in and does a reading and you can sort of play with it, you know, try this, let's try, you know, what if it, you know, what if you were angrier here and, you know, not so much there or something, just so you can kind of turn. I love turning a scene inside out with a performance because it's something unexpected, you know?
Well, it's also good to see if the actor's going to take your direction.
Sure.
You know?
Sure.
Because some actors don't. You want to know that. Well, so now it's just people submit videos. They don't come in for appointments.
Self-tape. They self-tape.
It's almost all self-tape.
I was going to ask, you know, from, you know, the DP's, you know, cinematographer point of view, wearing that hat, Phil, what are you particularly proud of? That you know, maybe a scene, a shot, an episode, you know, from The Sopranos that you really, you know.
Well, I mean, there's some great things in The Sopranos that I did that I'm very proud of. That show that Alan Taylor directed called The Ride, which was your show, Michael.
Oh, I love that one. Yeah.
I mean, there are multiple scenes in that episode that I'm like insanely proud of, and
that's a feast. The visual quality with the dolphins, the song, the Fred Neil song, the montage there. It's really beautiful. People talk about that a lot. Actually,
is that the one where Bobby goes after Paulie because the ride breaks?
Yes, correct.
When I went after Sirico. And I had to get pissed off. I just kept thinking of all the times he insulted me. It was very easy. It was very, I'm being dead serious.
And you didn't have to think too hard.
Because I was at the other end. And you know, Tony, I love him, but you know, he would, you know, constantly, whatever the fuck, being fat, whatever the fuck he says to you, when he says whatever comes to his, in his head. And I was at the other end of the feast, and I got to walk through and kind of go after him. And I was just fucking thinking, and I was getting more and more fucking pissed off. And then, you know, they stop me before I get to him. And then at one point he went, take it easy a little. Slow down. I went, I'm not going to fucking slow down, you know, because, you know, Paulie, how dare you, you know, I mean, because he.
Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, I remember that.
He told me to slow down, like, you know.
He liked to direct. Tony.
He did. Yeah,
Tony liked to direct.
You look at me. I'll look at you. Let me get my mug in there. Let me get my mug in there. Let me get a shot in there. You have any? Do you remember anything? I mean, of course, there's a million things, but something that stands out: a night, a shot, a scene that really, you go, "What the fuck? I'm never going to see this again."
I mean, I don't know, you know, memorable things like Pine Barrens was a really memorable show, you know, just in terms of having scouted it, you know, with no snow and then showing up and there's snow and, you know, things like that. And that was just crazy in the way and how amazing that show turned out. I do remember there was that scene, like we were there in the morning and we were figuring out one of the first things we were going to do, because we were worried about leaving tracks in the snow. There was something. And we were talking with the stunt guys when Paulie tumbles down the hill and he loses his shoe. There was a lot of conversations about how we can do this, because now the rocks were covered with snow and we couldn't see them. And there was no way to do it safely. And how was it? It was going back and forth. And where were we going to restage it? What were we going to do? And I remember Jimmy Levy, our Teamster captain, said, "What the fuck are you guys talking about?" He goes, "You do it like this." And he goes up to the edge and he tumbles down the cliff all through the rocks. Wow. And he stands up. He goes, "There, like that. What's so hard about that?"
Jimmy Levy was hardcore. He was a Marine. He was a martial artist. He was a dangerous guy.
That's Jimmy and Harry Levy.
Jimmy was our Teamster captain.
Those are good guys.
Oh, yeah. He was great. I mean, we all looked at each other like, what the hell? We had always imagined Jimmy Levy in that scene, like, you know, picture from like Apocalypse Now, still water, and up from the water comes Jimmy Levy. With like a necklace of ears, you know, it's like,
yeah, that's he wasn't Levy. Fucking around, Jimmy Levy.
Hardcore,
yeah. Very hardcore.
And then, of course, we had the famous lake house. Remember that one?
Oh, yeah.
And we were up there at the hotel, and we had a big.
That was bad.
We had a big party one night, because we had been up there, whatever the fuck it was, and I don't know what they did to Phil. had it one too many.
What are you speaking about specifically? Because
when we were in the bar and we sent one of the PAs out to get liquor because the bar was closed. We were in Tarrytown, and Phil had a couple drinks there, and I forgot what they did to you. They did something.
Well, I'll tell you. I do remember it was all Tim Van Patten, because Tim Van Patten, I was in a conversation with Eileen and we were off to one side, and all of a sudden the waitress would be bringing shots of tequila, and I'm like, and Tim Van Patten's over at the bar and he's got one. He's like, right? 10 shots later, I find out he's drinking water and he's sending me over tequila. So that was crazy. And I do also remember, embarrassing to say, but I'm going to say it anyway, that, you know, I had to take a leak and I'm like meandering through the bar and I come up to Jimmy Collins, another Teamster. And I go, "Jimmy," just like he's playing pool. I go, "Jimmy, where's the men's room?" And he goes, "Just past the second pool table." And I walk smack into a mirror, just like, boom. And I'm like, I mean, I just couldn't even really believe it. But that's crazy.
Phil was wounded for a couple of days. Yeah.
I was wounded, yeah. Yeah, we were all wounded.
Oh, yeah.
You weren't the only one.
No, there were a lot of stories, like for Jim as well and Tim as well, and a lot of stories.
We worked hard and we played hard. That's for sure. Yeah. And I was a member. I was happy to be a member in good standing.
I mean, you know, when you take a group like that on location, it's sort of like a recipe for those kinds of things to happen, you know.
It was like when you were a kid and you'd go on like a class trip overnight. It was kind of like that, you know. You get into all kinds of trouble.
Yeah, 7 years of a, it was 7 years of a class trip.
It was like that. Yeah,
yeah, that's very true. Very true.
And so, of the all these 1 hours, have you ever done a half hour? You directed a half hour? Only 1 hour shows.
Yeah, no, I've done a couple of half. I did Glow, which was just recently canceled, unfortunately.
Gorgeous Ladies of Wrestling.
Gorgeous Ladies of Wrestling was like a half hour show. I love that show. So that which, was sad to see that.
Believe it or not, when I was working at the Riviera, they were there, the original, the real Glow. I knew all those girls, the real ones, in 1986, 87. They lived in the hotel. Sylvester Stallone's mother, Jackie, was kind of the den mother, and they filmed there. They filmed the real Glow there.
They did the fights there at the Riv?
They did the fights there. I knew all the girls.
In the Riv, yeah. Wow.
At the Riv. All of them, the whole group. And
that's insane. Wow. You should have been a technical consultant on the show.
And the Mark Maron character. Mark Maron character is his name is he was married to Jane Mansfield. Get me the name. Married to Jane Mansfield. I knew him well.
I know who you're talking about.
Yeah, and he was the guy. He created this. The owner of the Riviera financed Glow. They were living in the hotel. They had like 80 rooms. They were all
was he
over
a wise
the
guy?
Place. He wasn't a wise guy. He made movies with Pia Zadora, Butterfly, and some other ones. And what the hell's his name? You got to help me here.
I auditioned for that part.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah? Mark Maron, it was, shit, it's on the tip of my tongue. Our guy can't do it, but whatever.
Was he Italian?
Nah, but he acted Italian.
No. Oh.
And he used to live in the hotel also. Rickless, Meshulam Rickless, he was
that
helping.
That was Pia's husband.
Pia Zadora's husband. Yeah. He financed these movies. She won a Golden Globe. He created Glow. And they were living there. It was pretty funny. I saw some episodes of the show. I liked it.
Yeah, it's a good show. I worked with Annabella. Sciorra was on that show.
Oh, really?
She was on it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Matt
she
Simba. His name was Matt Simba.
Oh, Matt.
C-I-M-B-E-R, Matt Simba. And he was married to James Mansfield, and that's the Mark Maron character, yeah. Yeah. He's still around. Matt is alive and well somewhere. And Phil, I couldn't thank you enough, honestly.
Thanks for coming on today, man. I appreciate it.
Great to see you.
Of course. It's really good to see you guys.
Enjoy your headset.
Yeah, same here.
You got your Bose headphones.
Fantastic. Right. Thank you very much.
Hope to see you on a set very soon, Phil.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's do that, please.
All let's right. get drunk again.
Sure.
Only I'll drink the shots of tequila. I'll drink them.
Good.
I won't fake
you
out.
Won't be drinking water.
I'll be with you. Michael's going to make a comeback. He hasn't been drinking, but he's going to make a comeback bigger than ever. Phil, bigger than ever. He's making a comeback.
Yeah, I'll see.
I'll see you, my friend.
Thanks, man.
All right, guys.
Take care.
Take care of yourself.
Good to see you both. All right. Take care.
All right.
Great guy.
Great
guy. And
lots of good behind the scenes.
Talented guy.
He was
great
there.
Guy.
He was through the whole thing. He was there. He saw a lot. He saw us at our best and at our worst.
And I was his favorite actor, but you cut him off before he could say that.
Well, I didn't want to hear it.
You're always putting me down. You're always putting me down.
I am not putting you down. I mean, I don't want this to be hijacked, this show to be hijacked about, you know, how great you were. It's not what we're doing here, Steve.
We'll be right back, man.
See you later. We'll be right back. All right. Season 3, episode 7, Second Opinion. is the title, which refers to Uncle Junior with his cancer diagnosis, but also with Carmela, who gets a second, her own second opinion after her appointment with Dr. Melfi. This air date originally aired on April 8th, 2001. Edie Falco won an Emmy for lead actress in a drama, and she submitted this episode for Emmy consideration, because that's what you do when you an actor gets nominated, the producers send in one episode for them to consider, really, the strongest episode.
And you pick it. They ask you which one you...
They ask you, or they suggest it sometimes, but they don't. The Emmy Commission doesn't look at the whole season, you know, because network TV, there's 22 episodes. That's a lot. They just look at one. Written by Lawrence Connor. It's first of two episodes he wrote. Now, Lawrence Connor also is the co-writer of Many States of Newark with David Chase. He's written for Boardwalk Empire. He wrote the movie Planet of the Apes, the reboot. His daughter Jenny Connor is the co-showrunner and was the co-showrunner and main writer, along with Lena Dunham of Girls, the series Girls. That's his daughter.
You did an episode of that, didn't you?
I did episode of the first season. I played a professor of literature. Which was actually a lot of fun. I enjoyed that a lot. This is directed by Tim Van Patten.
We open up. We're at the hospital. Junior's undergoing anesthesia. It's a dream sequence. They're counting down. Cocky is not the word for this doctor. You know, Sam McMurray, Dr. Kennedy.
Our friend Sam McMurray.
We know Sam.
Roger Haber client, right?
He's another Roger Haber, our infamous attorney. Sam is also under his tutelage. And you see two FBI agents come in. They show their badge. Junior's dreaming this. Give up your nephew, and we will give you the cure. He'll be cured of cancer. You also see a headline, a newspaper, where Junior is married to Angie Dickinson, who he's been pining over for years.
Also funny, though, is that doctor's name is John Kennedy, right? Which gives Junior, you know, that plays a lot in Junior's, you know, estimation of this doctor and his, you know, somehow the name makes Junior think he's a gift from God. Because he loves Kennedy. But Angie Dickinson had an affair with JFK.
Correct.
She said she slept with him and it was the most exciting 7 minutes of her life. That was the quote she said about, I swear, JFK. She also, talking about Angie Dickinson with presidents, she did a movie with Ronald Reagan called The Killers in, I think, 1964. It was based on an Ernest Hemingway short story. And Ronald Reagan smacks her, and then John Cassavetes punches out Ronald Reagan in the scene. It's a hilarious scene in the movie.
Is it a good
movie? Ronald Reagan was a hack, I have to say. A hack, you know, he was smart to get out of the business and go, hack city, Ronald Reagan.
Well, he was, I don't know, he was kind of a beloved president, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was president of SAG. Did you know that? Before
yeah,
he was, I think, governor. Before he was governor of California, he was president of SAG. Yeah, but
it shows
probably
you
wise.
Only in America. Only in America, a hack actor can become the president. You know, only
You don't hear many people going, you know what? I really want a good Ronald Reagan movie tonight.
Yeah.
Never hear that, do you?
No. Bongo. What's
John Wayne? You hear maybe
he was with the monkey, wasn't he? With the monkey.
Bedtime for Bonzo or whatever.
Bonzo. Yeah. Hospital waiting room. Dr. Kennedy comes out of the ER and he gives the news. Tony, Bobby, and the crew is there. The news is good. I took a tumor out the size of a fist. Kennedy walks away. Tony follows him, tells him, hey, doc, if there's anything I could do, I just wanted to say thanks. And the doctor kind of, he's very smug. He's very
doesn't
arrogant,
want to hear it.
Very condescending, kind of like, yeah, like, what are you going to do for me? That kind of thing.
He kind of high hats him.
I know the feeling well.
What's funny is when Junior's under and he's hearing Livia saying, I'm happy for you. And then he hears Tony saying, be happy, clip your coupons. And then he says, peppers and eggs or something. Yeah. He's in this dream state. And then what's funny, Tony Soprano is waiting for him in the waiting room. There's that his old man crew is there.
Yeah.
There's that Chooch, the character Chooch, and Beppe. They're all waiting for
the junior to come out. There's a few guys there, and we're waiting. And Bobby's wearing a nice purple jogging suit.
Nice. Do you still have that one?
No, I do not. I wish I did. He looks like Barney, the dinosaur. we're in the Bada Bing, back of the Bada Bing. Chris, Paulie, Silvio, Patsy, they're playing pool.
I played pool whenever I did a movie, when I played pool, somehow I became 10 times better at pool. When the camera was rolling, I could do the most amazing shots. And I'm not a good pool player. On camera, and when I'm very, very, very drunk, I become incredible. Like, I make shots that people, they can't even understand how I did it.
You rise to the occasion. You rise to the occasion.
If only the camera was rolling, that should be the name of my book. If only the camera was rolling. You know,
there you go.
I was in a dive bar in Old San Juan, Puerto Rico, called El Bate, which is open all the time. It doesn't close. So I was there with Ben Chaplin, and it was probably 6 in the morning. It was daylight, and the place was packed.
Oh, I like that.
From the night before, pretty much.
I like that.
And we were playing pool. I was out of my mind drunk, played the best game of pool I've ever. People were watching, applauding. It was crazy.
I like
El Bate, if you're ever in Old San Juan, you got to. There's a lot of bars in San Juan don't close. There's several that are open all the time. It's
I'm okay
but
with
El
that.
Bate,
like Vegas.
That's a good joint. Yeah.
They're playing pool. Christopher, he beats him. He says, that's three. You owe me $60. Paulie gives him the finger. Good luck getting it. You're too worried about what I give you. You should worry about what you give me. You know, and then Paulie pulls the bullshit of you wearing a wire, makes Christopher take his clothes off.
The scar is there from my spleen surgery. And Tony had to do a lot of acting to believe that his line about me, you know, he really had to.
About the dick?
Took a lot of work on his part.
Really?
Well, he had to really act.
Yeah.
And, you know.
Yeah, because he wouldn't believe that you called that a dick.
There you go.
And then you say, Christopher says, you know, what do you mean? He's been sticking you with tabs, you know. Paulie's kind of a prick. And he bought Dom Perignon at the Skybox at Madison Square Garden. That's a big number.
That's at least $500 a bottle.
A bottle of Dom in the Skybox at the Garden is a lot of money. You know, they humiliate him. Patsy sticks his nose in there. Patsy kind of has no balls, you know, when you call him on something, you know. And I like that Chris comes back at him. And then Silvio's there, kind of the voice of reason, prohibitionary period, he says. I don't know if I believe that or not. Soprano House, a family dinner, Carmela's parents. AJ's going to go his Washington trip. He doesn't want to go. Now, what made me laugh here, she says, AJ's saying how he doesn't want to go. Tony is so into eating this chicken leg that he's like daydreaming. He's got the chicken leg in his mouth.
Is it because of the chicken or is his mind on something?
Don't know what his mind would be on. He's eating that chicken leg, and she says, you want to weigh in on this? And what? He goes, what? And, you're going.
He's
it's paid
for. Attention.
He's loving. He's enjoying the hell out of this chicken leg. The beeper goes off. I got to go. Problems at work. Carmela's parents are there. They're just the best. They're two of the best characters.
Hilarious.
She says he's got two speeds, moping or yelling.
He brings up the escarole with the balsamic, and Hugh says, my mother never heard of balsamic. Which, you know, like, there's certain things when I was young growing up, I never heard of either, and then they became popular. Like, I never heard of balsamic. Did you hear that?
No,
they didn't
probably
have that in your house when you were a kid?
No, because it probably wasn't popular. That's kind of a
a northern Italian thing. Even pesto, when I was a kid, I never heard of pesto till I was an adult.
It's
extra virgin olive oil, I never heard of that. You had olive oil, that was it. You know, these things kind of came into vogue later on, right?
Like artesian pizza and all this other stuff, kind of, right? Certain kinds of, listen, you had two kinds of mozzarella in the old days, right? You had the, you know, fresh made mozzarella, polio, that was in the refrigerator, you know, refrigerator right, section.
In or supermarket,
smoke mozzarella. That was it, right? Right. It's very funny. They bring up Angelo Stanfa. He owns a street. He wanted to marry Carmella in the old days. And Mary brings up Angelo Stanfa. You could have married him. Of course, Tony gets up and leaves. He's got to go to work, leaves Sunday dinner. And he owns a string of drugstores, Stanford drugstores. They have an argument. She gets pissed off. You're blowing this out of proportion, Mary says. Carmella gets up from the table, goes into the kitchen, and she kind of lays it on him.
She calls them out, on their hypocrisy and saying, well, when it was beneficial for you, when you needed strings pulled for your residential zoning contract, you know, then it was okay for Tony to be who he is. And now you're giving, you know, now you're talking shit about him. But she calls them, on it, and rightfully so there.
She says, the water's part for you. She says, I earn it. You get a free pass. And, you know, they didn't like when she said that she was going to therapy. They did not like.
Yeah, they found that very disturbing. They don't get it. They imagine the worst, you know, because they probably think, wow, they must seriously have problems in the bed, problems, mental problems, you know, because that older generation, they didn't do therapy. That was you had to have severe mental problems to go to, you know, see a psychiatrist. It wasn't like now it's very commonplace. It's very accepted. There's not a stigma. But back then, so they're thinking the worst.
Yeah, absolutely. You know? I mean, there was a stigma to it. I like when she's telling you about Tony got it rezoned to help him. He goes, bullshit.
Right. Tom Aldridge, that was one of his lines.
Todd
he said that Aldridge a lot.
Bullshit. Great. Bullshit. Yeah. He
defends Tony too, though. You know, if you notice, he when it's a nice example for his son, Hugh kind of defends him. Hey, the guy works, you know.
And he also says he's got an uncle. He's got an uncle that's got cancer, and that's when Mary says,
he's got an uncle
"Oh,
that's got
they
cancer.
Didn't talk for a year, or whatever it was." You know, the back room, the bada bing, Silvio and Furio, they're playing cards. Tony arrives. He sees the big mouth Billy Bass.
Big Mouth Billy Bass was a popular thing back then too. It was a lot of people were buying that. It plays the song "Take Me to the River," which is of course Al Green, written by Al Green and Teeny Hodges. Teeny Hodges, a guitarist, a Memphis soul guy who also co-wrote "Love and Happiness" and "Here I Am" with Al Green and a lot of other songs. Really good documentary by a friend of mine, Susanna Vapnek, made about Teeny Hodges. Really good movie if you guys are into that. But Tony don't like seeing that.
No, it reminds him of, you know, he's having a flashback to Big Pussy and the killing of Big Pussy and the fish that he dreamt talked to him, and he does not like it. So he goes outside, where to come from. They tell him it was Georgie. George, not many people in the club. Georgie is back there washing glasses, and Tony comes and hits him in the head. He's already got the patch from when Ralphie hit him in the eye with the chain and lock.
With the chain.
And Georgie gets it again. Very innocently, he saw it at Rite Aid, he said. He bought this thing for a few laughs, and he got beaten up with it. I'd like
what do
it
you
to
think? He said, what do you think, it's a playroom here?
I'd like
place
it to
of business.
I'd like at the beginning, as he's hitting him, they're still dancing, the girls. You know, then it finally sure is, they stop.
There's dancing to "Mysterious Ways" by our friends, U2. You know, Steve and I went to see U2 together and got invited to meet the band backstage at the Madison Square Garden.
Yeah, that was.
We
good.
Have a picture somewhere of us all.
I
there
got
with
a picture.
Bono.
I got a picture of Bono. I'm on the end, and my wife is next to Bono, and you and your wife, and my wife covers up and says, were you there that night? Bono kissed her on the lips. Hello. It's a little out of line, fucking Bono.
He kissed her on the lips?
Kissed her on the lips. Bono.
Really?
little out of fucking line, Bono. And, nah.
But you don't listen to them anymore. Okay.
Nah, I don't care. And I like The Edge. I did a charity thing with The Edge. I auctioned off his guitar. Nah, I'm fucking around, but that's true. He did kiss her on the lips, but whatever, man. Melfi's office. Carmella comes in. She's staring at the statue in the waiting room.
It's same shot as Tony in the pilot, looking at the statue. It's from the behind the statue, between the legs. Same exact shot. Mimics the shot exactly. She's kind of staring at the statue, almost comparing it to, I don't know, to something. Is she comparing it to herself or whatever she's thinking about? She's at Melfi's alone for the first time.
Yes.
This is the first time. Is it because Tony bailed or she just wanted to go alone?
He said he was sick. He's lying. He didn't feel like coming. And she said she's going to go anyway. She's already feeling, you know, she's feeling crappy. We know that from when Tony gets up from Sunday dinner. He gets up and he leaves. I mean, you know, it's Sunday dinner. She went through all this trouble, all this cooking, right. And he just got up. He got beeped, and who knows where he goes. Like she says later on in the episode, he answers to a strip club. Who knows?
He reports to a strip club.
You know,
and this has been going on for a long time.
For a while. It's been brewing. You know, she's starting, we're going to see, but she's starting to feel unwanted. She's starting to feel taken advantage of. All true. All true, by the way. She's saying, I'm worried about my husband. The mood swings. Half the time he doesn't talk to me. He reports to a strip club. Who knows how he spends his days? She tells Melfi she loves the paintings outside, but the statue is not her favorite. She loves the country paintings. It would be better for Tony. She thought it would be better when Livia died. She thought Tony would be better. She was waiting on that. When Livia died and he had his mother and all that, Michigas is in the past.
The mood swings.
Things would be better, yeah.
Yeah.
She's upset.
And then she gets
crying.
Angry and she says, fuck that shit. You know, she reports to a strip club. She's also, her attitude, she doesn't seem like she wants to be there. She's a little annoyed with Melfi. She's like, you give me the silent treatment. And Melfi's like, is that what you think? This is a silent treatment. And she says, I'm not the one. And Melfi recommends a therapist. She said, you know, second opinion. Again, this feeds into the title. And Carmella said, I'm not the one who needs mental help. You know, I just need to vent. And she, you know, Melfi says, I have a colleague in Livingston who was my ex-teacher. But, you know, if you want, here's his name. We don't know if she's going to go see him or not, but she gets the name. But she's
well. She takes the card.
She takes the card, but you know she was happy when Tony decided to go to therapy in the first season, right? She thought that was a good idea, but since she started going with Tony, there's you know it has not been something she seems
into at all.
Well,
she said things were better. She told her parents things were better since they're going to therapy.
Well, I think that's a lie.
You may very well be right. Dr. Kennedy's office. You know, we shot this. We were at the golf course in New Jersey. And they were shooting the scene where Furio and Tony, which we'll see comes later on, in the golf cart. But this office was in the clubhouse of the...
In the clubhouse? Oh, really? So Dr. Kennedy's office was it a clubhouse? Well, maybe the manager's office or something like that?
It was a clubhouse at the golf course. The country club. It was a country club.
Country club. And Junior, he can't do any no wrong in Junior's eyes.
No.
The pictures, he should be in National Geographic. He's so
gushing.
Impressed with everything. He's gushing.
He's gushing.
He also went to Harvard, if you notice. The diploma says Harvard, which did JFK go to Harvard?
I think so. I'm not sure. We'll ask Andy about that. Let me ask you, what is your opinion of the Kennedys? What do you think about all that? Because he's worshipped, and there was so much corruption surrounding the Kennedys to this day, with Ted and even with Bobby. I mean, what do you think? I mean,
they represented a certain time in America and an optimism. You know, they were, you know, JFK did go to Harvard, but JFK and Jackie O, and they were young, they were good looking, they had a lot of charisma. You know, they did fight for civil rights. That was a big thing, especially Bobby. That was, you know, his thing. And there was a certain, listen, they called it Camelot. It seemed like it was almost larger than life. It was this picture, you know, post-war America.
The father was...
I don't mean the father. The father was a gangster, basically.
Yeah.
They said, right?
And they recruited Sam Giancana and Sinatra, and then they turned on them. It was very corrupt. JFK, you know, turned on Frank. That was a big thing, Frank Sinatra. He didn't stay at his house in Palm Springs. They kind of double-crossed the mob, and they double-crossed Frank Sinatra. And I mean, I'm just wondering, I don't really have an opinion. This is common knowledge. I mean, he was banging anybody he
Marilyn,
could.
Marilyn Monroe
and all the same. You know, I just, you know, they put on a pedestal, but, you know, I don't know.
I think it's more what they represented than maybe in actuality would happen. I mean, it's... you know, there was a lot of good intentions, I think. You know, a corrupt politician, that's nothing surprising. You know, did you ever see the movie JFK? That Oliver Stone, which I really love that. I think it's a really good, I don't know how true it is.
No, I did.
But I think it's a really good movie. You should see it. You would really like it.
I saw Chappaquiddick about Ted Kennedy.
Ted. I didn't see that.
I saw that. It was a good movie. I mean, it's horrifying what he did. You know, I did a show for Discovery a number of years ago, and it was about the mob. There was like three or four of them, and I was on location, and, you know, one was different mob things. And I did it like in the early 2000s, and one of them was JFK and the mob. And it was about Marilyn Monroe and this and that, and they made us pull it. I believe someone there was friendly with one of the Kennedys, and even though it's common knowledge that he had an affair with Marilyn, that's what it was about, Marilyn and JFK, the mob.
They pulled it.
They pulled it. They didn't air it. They only aired two or three of them, and I just thought that was just so fucking wrong. You know, I was furious.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, talk about censoring.
Rightfully so.
And it was because an executive there was friendly with somebody in the Kennedys, you know. You know, I did have dinner with Bobby Kennedy's daughter for a charity thing, Kathleen, who I liked very much. I believe it was Kathleen.
I met JFK Jr. He came to see a play I did once, and I liked him a lot. He was a really good guy. Liked him very much.
And I liked her. She was great. I'm just saying, you know, there's certainly not cut and dry there. That's for sure. But
No.
You know,
definitely not.
Kennedy is cocky. Sam McMurray plays this great. There's cells that he didn't get. We didn't get it all. Basically, Kennedy fucked up, and he didn't get all the cancer, and he's saying, I got to go back in. Anything you want, Doc, anything you want. You shit on the deck, the Queen Mary, and they're disinfected. And Bobby asked one stupid question about his diet. When could he eat solid food again, which I guess really isn't all that stupid a question.
It's actually a very smart question, but Junior looks at you like you said, you know, the most idiotic thing at all. Yeah.
So we're on the way home. Of course, that's a camera car. They're pulling us. How do I know? He asked him, what's nodal?
Nodal involvement.
Nodal involvement means, Bobby says, how do I know what it means? The whole issue of USA News, seniors and health says, bring somebody with you to the doctor, someone to ask questions. You ask one dumb question. He's yelling at Bobby, just abusing the poor fucking guy.
Bobby has to take a lot of
He's a punching bag, man. He's a punching bag.
Because Junior's a miserable person. And
he's
just
a miserable.
He
plays it great. Dominic's great in this episode.
We got to take a break. We'll be back.
Carmela's shopping, runs into Angie Bompensero, not by accident at all.
What do you mean?
I believe Angie Bompensero went there to possibly bump into Carmella.
Really?
That's what I think.
She's
I
got do. Coupons in her hand. She's but not listen, looking so good. She's clipping saw, coupons.
But she saw Carmella. Yet she went down to the meat section and then acted surprised when Carmella pulled
oh,
up.
Oh, really?
She saw her.
She you think she might have followed her?
I don't know about following, but let me shop here. Who knows? Maybe I'll run into Carmella so I could state my
shake her down.
Kind of, Carmella. You know, with pussy gone, things are tough. Shopping for one is no picnic. Why don't you come over to the house? It's a bad time for Coco. she says.
The vet says I got to put her down. I want another operation. Second opinion again. We're bringing up second opinions. She needs $1,200 for the surgery.
Dog Coco is not a replacement for human contact. Why don't you come? And she says, you know, even though Tony's generous, I need $1,200 for the dog. The dog is sick. It helps what Tony gives me, but it's not enough. It's a struggle. Now, I don't know. Why would Tony, is this a thing? Why would Tony give the widow, it's not a widow. It's not the widow. If it was a widow, I get it. Her husband became a snitch, went to the witness protection program, supposedly. Why is he giving her money?
A good question.
Why is he paying her now?
Because he may feel maybe he had a soft spot for the kids. I don't know.
I'm just surprised. You know, I'm just surprised that a guy that he's claiming.
He just don't cut her off. Yeah.
He's claiming snitch that it's like, you know, hey, Chris and Adriana's apartment.
She's watching Everybody Loves Raymond.
Yeah, it's a good show. Ray Romano, good man.
Ray Romano.
Chris arrives with a bag of Jimmy Choo shoes. They're all yours, baby, and they're from next season. You can't even buy them. He puts the shoes, which is very bad. You put the shoes on the table, which is a very bad luck sign. Very
I thought it was just the dining dinner table, not
no,
a
table. Any table. Any table.
Any table?
No
what
shoes
about,
on the table.
I thought it was
table.
The bed.
No, that's a hat on the bed. No hat on the bed. No hat on the bed. Look it up. Have I ever said anything wrong? Have I ever stared you wrong?
I've never seen. You know what? I've never seen a hat on your bed. Now
that's
I've come
correct.
To think of it.
Correct. And you and you've been
not once have I seen a hat on your bed.
No see, hats I've on the never, bed. No shoes on the table.
No shoes on the table.
She's looking at the right. shoes. They're a size 10. She says I'm an 8.5. And Chris says he doesn't give Paulie a full cut. Fuck him and the coupe de Philly rode in on. So Paulie's breaks Chris's balls, and Chris gets him back in his own silent way by shortchanging him. That's okay.
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with that.
No,
Paulie's being a prick.
They all do that, I'm sure. But when it ends, the scene does end with the two of them kissing. You know, they're in love, and it cuts to from Chris and Adriana cutting to Tony and Carmella, who it's cold. There's a distance. You know, he says the food is cold, like their relationship is cold. You know, there's just a lack of love, a lack of spark between them. And this is a kind of a thing in this episode.
You know, she says you could have called. You know, they're at the she's at the kitchen. She's reading at the kitchen table. Tony walks in. Of course, he's late. You could have called. Now everything's cold. I thought we could have dinner together. I mean, what is she asking? She's not anything asking so bad. She wants to have dinner with her husband. The kids are out of the house. They're empty nesters for, you know, this weekend anyway.
He doesn't want to be there.
He does not want to be there. And she mentions, I'm having lunch with the dean's daughter tomorrow, with our daughter's dean tomorrow. I gather you won't be joining us, the dean of Columbia University. All those people, they just want our money. I think Carmella's kind of flattered that the dean asked her to lunch. In a way, she's flattered.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I ran into Angie Bombacero. How's she doing? Her dog is sick. She needs money for an operation. He gets mad.
And he don't like hearing that. No.
No. He doesn't like hearing it at all.
And is part of it because of the fish? Is he still carrying a little bit of that?
Maybe.
Billy Bass, Billy Bass, yeah.
Came up twice in one day. Dean is an asshole, is trying to shake them down. Columbia was 40,000 a year back then.
It's a lot more now, right?
Now it's got to be 70 to 80, I would say. You know, wow. The dog has osteoporosis. Tony goes on a rant. He ratted us out to the FBI. He says, pussy's in the witness protection program. Ungrateful cunt wife. She says, what kind of wife? Come, let me tell you something. If you ever want to end with your girlfriend, your wife, even a guy, you want to end the argument, call somebody a cunt. It's over. And you'll never hear the end of it. But they'll be so furious at you, it's over.
And you know this from firsthand.
I know this from many experiences. One, I had a fight with an attorney. I was playing basketball. His name was Conan something, Smith maybe. But an attorney in Vegas, a Mormon guy. And I called him a cunt. And we went at it. And I got suspended for a month from the gym. Once we were arguing, fuck you. And then I went, you know, you're just a fucking big cunt. That was it. It's on. You call your wife a cunt or your girlfriend a cunt.
No,
it's over.
I've never done that.
It's over. I'm telling you now, she'll be so furious, it's all over. That's all I'm
saying.
But
he doesn't call her, he doesn't call Carmella that.
No.
He's referring to Angie.
I'm just giving advice out there. If you want it to end, you'll never hear the end of it. You're going to pay the price.
I'll keep that. I'll put that in the book.
You're going to pay the price. But I'm just telling you, you will pay. But it's argument over.
Argument over. All
right. Okay. That's all I'm saying. Christopher's apartment. Christopher and Adriana lie in bed. They're talking about old lovers. Very
old
bad.
Lovers and the oldest. Who was the oldest person you had sex with? Bad conversation.
Bad.
You never
bad.
Bring up any. You
never,
don't do
never ask the questions you don't want to know the answer to. Listen
so
to
he
me.
He says Chucky Pericchio's mother. So you figure she probably when they were in, he was like a kid. He was in high school or little, just out of high school. She was probably like 40.
Neighborhood woman,
and then he asks her, the oldest, and she says, Penn, from Penn and Teller. And he goes, which one was he?
Yeah. Hilarious.
And she says, Penn Gillette, who's the big one in the bathroom. And you see, know Penn Gillette,
I know
right?
Penn and Teller. I know both of them.
Penn
I know them
Teller.
Pretty well, yeah.
Penn was a good friend of Lou Reed's. They were actually very good friends, Penn Gillette.
And Teller, who doesn't talk on stage, I mean, he talks in real life. You know, I've had a few conversations with him. He's a very nice, intelligent guy. It's funny. She says, you know, the magicians. And Chris says, you fuck them? Like both of them.
And, like they do everything together.
Yeah. You fuck them.
They come as a duo, as a team. They come as a team.
Let me tell you, this
team,
is like, just, don't ever, listen. I'm kind of like the Goomba Dr. Phil here. Don't ever talk about old lovers, who you banged, how many people you banged, when you banged them. You know, it was.
Oh,
at
he
a
asked who's your most famous. That's what he asked.
Yeah, but this
not
was
oldest,
this was pillow
was
talk.
Famous.
Obviously, they just had sex. This was pillow talk. They're feeling that kind of thing, and of course, Chris goes crazy. She says she gave him head in the bathroom. He followed her in. You fucking whore, Chris.
And not right, a really bad territory to go to.
Do not go there. And
to
then
all the kids listening to this podcast, never talk about stuff like that. Kids.
Don't ask how many women, guys you've been with, she's been with. Do not ask. You don't want
to. Don't ask questions you don't want to know the answer to.
There you go. I'm telling you, that's no truer words have been spoken.
And then. Enter Paulie at 2:00 in the morning, and
Christopher
he sees
goes to
the
get
shoes.
The gun.
He gets the gun. He's yeah, but he sees the shoe. Paulie sees the shoes, and he knows that it's something he should have gotten a taste out of, right?
Oh yeah, he's there upset. To see what else is around. He's looking around. This is his purpose. Come here to break balls. He's way out of line, Paulie. You're a man. Christopher's a made guy. 2 a.m. It's very disrespectful.
He I comes don't care, in with probation. Patsy.
He's out of line. Way out of line.
Is this based on true stuff? Do you have you heard this kind of thing?
I would imagine they did. I have never heard this. I would imagine. You know, they're breaking his balls. They're, you know, he's the new guy. He's the pledge. He's the fraternity brother, and they're breaking his balls. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Absolutely, positively. He says, my broad is wears a size 10. Patsy starts packing him up. Patsy's a real suckhole, too. Patsy character.
Yeah.
He's a suckhole. He's, you know, he's shoving the shoes in the plastic garbage bags, and Christopher C. and Adriana's pissed. She really wants these shoes. This is a big deal. What do they go for? They go for a lot of money. These shoes,
very expensive. And he was gonna exchange them for her size. And now he doesn't have anything to exchange, so she's pissed off. And then he gets really pissed off when he sees Paulie in Adriana's bedroom sniffing her panties.
Yeah, out of line.
Which, but now think about it. This is the underwear drawer, so they're clean panties coming from the laundry.
Maybe he was hoping.
They're going to smell like detergent.
Maybe he was hoping.
Well, nobody puts used panties back in the drawer.
Listen, do you know what they do? Do you know what everyone does? Some people wear underwear and panties
well, he's just
for two
doing
or three days at a
see.
Clip.
And puts them back in a drawer? I don't know. I've never done that. But maybe Paulie's doing that for just to shove it up Christopher's ass, that he knows Christopher's looking, maybe.
Did he know he was looking? I don't think he did.
I don't know.
I don't
Well,
think
Chris
he
doesn't
did.
See him look, but maybe he did. I don't know. Good question.
Now, you know, now, speaking of used panties, you know, I used to work with some porn stars back in the day, in the mid-90s.
Where?
At the Riviera.
Where did you work with porn stars?
I used to hire.
Doing what?
They did a show for me, Crazy Girls and Porn Stars. Shayla LaVeau, Felicia, Jenna Jameson, Nikki Tyler, 90s porn stars. Jenna Jameson.
And they would do a show
years.
For you?
Yeah, well, they would. We had a show. It was during
like a cabaret.
Yeah, you know, we already had that Crazy Girl show I've talked about. They were topless, and we would incorporate the porn stars. It was my idea because they weren't coming to regular shows. All these guys for the Consumer Electronics Show, all these men were in town. The strip clubs were packed and not going to regular shows. So I said, why don't we try some? We hired porn stars. I started making calls. I didn't know anybody. Started calling these
Who'd
companies.
You call?
Wicked Pictures, Steve Orenstein. We became good friends. There's Steve Hirsch. His sister from the other big company, you know, the big porn companies. And I said, this is like a, you know, a showgirl. It's not a strip club. They weren't giving lap dances. It was nothing like that. They were from, you know, they were on stage from afar. Choreographed. They came in. They were great. The girls were great. Every year we had different ones, you know, and it worked out. It worked out great. But a couple of them, we would, you know, sit around talking afterwards, and men would buy their used panties, and they would buy them on the internet, pay a lot of money for them.
And, like how much?
$1,500.
No.
Dirty, dirty. Listen, I'm going to keep this clean. Dirty, dirty, dirty panties, shall we say. And guys would pay for them, and they would FedEx it. I'm telling you, a lot of money, a lot of money.
Do you think we could do that? Talking Sopranos,
as used I said, my underwear. Yeah, I think that's a thing. It could be a thing.
Andy, look into this. Maybe there's a market for us.
The underwear
the merch, page.
Talking Soprano logo. On the underwear. But I'm being serious. They told me that that was
I'm sure
part
that,
of the thing.
That makes
also,
sense.
Another thing in those days, this is before smartphones. I'm talking 95, 6, 7.
So no porn was mostly like DVDs and DVDs?
After the shows, they would work strip clubs. Okay, so a porn star would work a strip club. They got on the box cover. They were headliners now. They would go into a town. Go into a town, wherever, the Midwest, you know, so-and-so. And after the show, for 10, 15 bucks, take Polaroids. The guys would line up. They would make, you know, thousands of dollars more. Guys would line up. And also, lollipops, they would...
No.
And sell them for $40. I'm telling you. This is true. I didn't make this up. There's people out there, I'm sure, know better than me, but I'm just telling you. So I don't want to go down a dark path, but I guess...
We just did.
But Andy, please check on that. Please
Andy, check on the lollipops, Talking Sopranos.
All right.
All-day suckers. We're going to sell.
Meadows dorm room. Carmela knocks on the door. Meadows out.
Columbia. That song is Nils Lofgren. Black yeah. Books. Nils Lofgren played in probably the two greatest backing bands ever in rock. The E Street Band with Bruce, of course, uh-huh. and Little Steven, and Crazy Horse with Neil Young. And this is from his Damaged Goods album, 1995, Black Books. The lyrics are great because it really refers to Carmela. Too many different dreams to satisfy. She wants new shoulders to cry on, new backseats to lie on. She wants to see other guys get lost in other eyes. It's definitely what Carmela's dealing with. And you know what's interesting? When Carmela's sitting in the waiting area there, waiting for Meadow, behind her, out the window is the storefront of a pharmacy.
Oh,
and they referred to
that.
Her ex-boyfriend who was in love with her, who owned a string of pharmacies, and the song is playing.
That.
Interesting, yeah.
You know, Carmela is a good mother. I mean, she slept all the way up there. She brings her laundry. She brings her ziti with sweet sausage. And she's just treated like shit. I really feel bad for Carmela in this scene. She's sitting there waiting. It's 2 p.m. They're really taking advantage of her, you know. And, you know, she goes into the dorm room. And, you know, I got to tell you, Meadow's going to the school, paying a fortune. They're paying for the room and board, the dorm. And she's home constantly. You know, it's like, really, at one point in one of the episodes, she said, what am I paying for the dorm for? Because it really is. She goes there for the laundry and food. I mean, the whole idea is kind of you grow up, you're on your own. You do your own laundry,
right.
You get your own food. No one's there to wake you up. You know what I mean? You got to be a class. You know what I mean? That's part of going away to school, which your son is doing, my daughters did. It's part of the growing up process. They got to take their responsibility, and
right.
That's not what's happening. You know what I mean?
Well, and Carmela's kind of enabling that by coming, bringing her the laundry, bringing her the ziti.
1,000%.
She shows her that flyer. I thought that was funny. CIA. She goes, you should go see this seminar. Look at what's happening. Take advantage. CIA in the Cultural Cold War, and that lamp that was in the basement that was bugged by the FBI
is
in the frame at that moment too, which I think is kind of funny.
You know, she says, you know, she comes in, she's kind of, Meadow's very nasty to her. I don't think Carmela deserves this. Very nasty. Uses her like kind of as a punching bag too. She tells him that she's meeting Dean Ross. You're meeting with the dean. Oh, his secretary called me last week and invited me. She's very proud of this, Carmela. She knows that. They want money from her.
Yeah, but they know, the dean knows that that works often. You know? People, even though they know it's a shakedown, basically, to some degree, likes it.
She comes into Manhattan. She's dressed. She's going to have lunch with the dean. She mentions about, I just came to check about your breakup with Noah. She says something, I lost a great man. She says, well, if I recall, you were with him longer than the incident with Tony. You know, when Noah came to the house, you know, Tony was very rude to him, as we know. But they continued to go out for quite a while, and then the thing fizzled. Or Noah just got what he wanted and moved on.
Yeah, I think he got tired of her. I don't know if he just got, it was just about getting what he wanted. I think he just kind of found her. I think he was honest, and he said, you're kind of a negative person. And I think it was bumming her out. I think it's interesting. She holds up the book. Carmela holds up the book that Meadow has on the desk, Theory of Leisure Class. It's by someone named Thorstein Veblen from 1899. It's about conspicuous consumption by the upper class and how that kind of luxury and leisure is useless activities that don't contribute to the economy and exploits the working class. Very much what we talked about in the last episode about capitalism. That last episode was almost a critique of capitalism and stuff. And again, they're making points about this. And this comes back in this episode too, about the difference in class and aspiring to be, you know, rich and how that, you know, plays into, capitalism and all these things. It's interesting.
You know, Meadow's very condescending. You know, she's a college girl now. She's using big words. Carmela tells her about the book she's reading. Oh, I wish I could read fiction, you know, because she's just so busy. And we know college kids are busy, but, you know, there's plenty of time for fun, you know. At Junior's house, he's making a shake. He leaves the top off. It spills
what
all
is
over
he
the
making?
Counter.
Yeah.
I like a nutritional steak. He said Kennedy says he has to anything through a straw. No
solid
food.
It looks like
food.
He was putting tuna in there and avocado and milk or something.
It's... Well, maybe instead of a sandwich, he was. It looks disgusting. It doesn't look good.
It looks disgusting.
And he comes in.
You know, I wanted just one second to go back to the thing. You know, Meadow calls her and says about the bullshit accommodating pretense you got worked out with Tony. Meadow calls Carmela on that, you know, and. This kind of comes back later in this episode when Carmela sees a therapist. You know what I mean? But Meadow's calling her on it then. I wanted to just point that out. I think it's important. So Junior puts the blender on and goes all over
the blender on.
Plate.
It spills everywhere. He's just had it between the cancer and he can't get a hold of Kennedy. The whole thing is just coming to a head for Junior. Tony comes in. Junior's worried because he's on parole, probation. I guess he still has the ankle bracelet on. That Tony's coming in. He sneaks in through the basement. He says, where's Bacala? He says, yeah, I sent him out for Pepto-Bismol because of the stomach. He mentions Ralph Cifaretto. I hear there's bad blood. What's going on with that? Bobby comes in. Junior says, you stopped at White Castle, didn't you? Bobby says, no. He says, I could smell them. Now, you know, if you ever ate a White Castle, you could smell it.
White Castle, you could smell. First of all, White Castles smell better than they taste in a way. Like, you know, the smell gets you first. You know, I remember I was a teenager, probably like 19, maybe 18. And I was out with my friends really late. We drank a lot. And I slept late the next day. I was living with my grandparents. My father shows up probably 12, 1 o'clock in the afternoon with a bag of White Castles.
Hey, nice.
And it just made me feel – but I was already very hungover, feeling really sick. And that smell came in the house and just made everything worse. But if you're not hungover or you – you know, they're a good late night thing. Like if you've been out kind of drink, you know, we used to hang out near Fordham University. Yeah. There was some bars over there. We used
they're
to hang out
around,
there when we were teenagers. You know. And there's a White Castle right there by Fordham over there. And we used to go there. That's a good, that was
around.
One of the first, I think.
You know, the blackout, when was the blackout here? 2003 or something? The last one, the big blackout. My family was back in Vegas. I was alone at my apartment in Battery Park City, and I was on the 20th floor at the time, and then all the lights go out. So I was all alone. I had a few bottles of wine around the house, whatever. I drank. I was getting drunk, and then we had frozen White Castles in the freezer for the kids, and nothing worked. So I ate them half fucking frozen. I was starving. I was drunk. I ate about six of them, and then I fell asleep. Woke up the next fucking day. I was like drunk. They were like basically half frozen. There was no half microwave. Frozen, yeah. There was nothing I could do.
You couldn't heat them up. Yeah.
I couldn't that's do anything. But so that's what that reference to. For people that don't know what White Castle is, they're square little hamburgers. They used to be 15 cents. I don't know what they cost
now. And they're
now.
Steamed. That's the yeah. specific thing about them. They're steamed. And they got onions serve a little on them. Chopped onion on them. They're steamed. They're really, they're not fried.
And they really and smell.
Not grilled.
Yeah, they really
and
smell.
And they're pretty great, though, I have you to know. Say. If you're in the mood for them, they're really good.
He tells, Junior tells Tony that we're going to cut again. They're going to, that Kennedy is going to perform surgery again. He says, let's get a second opinion. You know, he said, well, you come with me and blah, blah, blah. Then when Tony leaves, Tony agrees to come with him to the doctor. And once again, he says, Anthony is a cunt hair away from owning all of New Jersey, and I am that cunt hair. Bobby doesn't believe him. Bobby says, why are you so cynical? I mean,
all this cynicism is no good.
And it's true, because this is not what's happening, you know. This is
no,
not
he wants
happening.
To help him, you know. But and Junior doesn't want a second opinion. He thinks Kennedy has the hands of an angel. Don't forget the name. He bring, you know, like somehow the name, the fact that he's named John Kennedy somehow makes him a good doctor. Then he also says, I love that man. He was older than me, and look at him now. He's talking about President Kennedy. I mean, which is just, it's just hilarious. I mean, such good writing.
You know, Junior, doctors don't like character. When you get second opinion, a lot of them.
Doctors have egos. They like to be, you know, especially, you know, when they're surgeons, cancer surgeons, they are, you know, they're like put on a pedestal, yeah. You know, like you said before. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do they not like second opinions? They don't encourage.
A lot of, you know, years ago, I hurt my hand. And I went to, you know, I went to see this doctor, and he gave me kind of the, this was in Vegas, kind of the bum's rush. Like, yeah, because he had put a pin in my friend's hand. You know, I was working as a bouncer then. And he said, you're going to get one of those also. And he already was setting up the thing. Okay, we'll do it next week.
The surgery.
Boom, 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 boom. I mean, like that quick. And I was... This is like 83, man, 84. I was young, you know. I wasn't that, you know, savvy a guy. And he said, yeah, it's gonna happen. We're gonna do it. Da 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 da. I was like, whoa. So I had the appointment. I went out of there, and I spoke to a friend of mine who was a chiropractor, and he said, you know, get a second opinion. I mean, what was this guy? I said, kind of gave me the bum's rush. I'll be honest. He didn't explain shit. He just said he's gonna put a pin in my finger. It's my middle finger on my right hand, and I called the doctor to, like, because it was going to be like the next day or 2 days, and I called him. I said, listen, doctor, I want to get a second opinion. Well, it's your hand, do what you want. And I was,
yeah, it is your hand. That's
and I was
right.
real but I was hand. Really stunned by the attitude. I really was.
Yeah,
I
mean, sure. That's
was like,
a bad
well,
attitude.
Instead of saying, sure, why don't you go and do that?
Whatever you want to do, blah. When you're ready, come back.
When you're ready, I'm here for you. Nope. Yeah, it's your hand, you do whatever you want. Boom. Hung up.
That's a bad doctor. Did you have to get surgery?
No. So I went to this other guy, Dr. Seferstini, I'll never forget his name, Italian guy. And he said, listen, your finger's never going to be 1,000% anyway. Let's try a splint. If that doesn't work, we'll do the surgery. I never got the surgery. Never had to get it. See?
Wow.
Yeah, he didn't like that.
So there's another. Get a second opinion, folks.
Yeah, he didn't like it. Dean Ross takes Carmella to lunch.
Dean Ross. That's Frank Wood. Frank Wood did the play Sideman with Edie Falco, which was written by Warren Light, who's the showrunner, writer, Law & Order SVU. I was in his first movie that he directed and wrote called The Night We Never Met. I had a little part, but it starred.
I love that movie.
Yeah, that star, I had a little part. Annabella Matthew Broderick.
I love
Warren,
it. Dominic's
that was
in
his
it.
Movie.
Dominic Chianese's in it.
Dominic's in it. Louis Black.
I love that movie. Very underrated
but Frank,
movie.
Yeah, but Warren wrote the play Sidemen that Frank Wood was in, and they worked. Edie was in this play. They did it off Broadway, wound up going to Broadway. Now, would you call Dean? It was Dean Rossetti. They changed it to Dean to Ross. Is that a Wonder Bread WAP in
Absolutely.
Your estimation?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Wonder Bread WAP all day long. He hangs out with Cusimano, Dean Ross. Him and Dr. Cusimano, they would
Melfi's
be friends. And Melfi's ex. Yeah, they would all hang out together. All cut from the same cloth. He speaks Italian. He's trying to impress, obviously, Carmela, and she is impressed.
And he does this all the time. Yeah. Did you encounter this in, like, when the kids were in private school or even college?
Oh, absolutely. My daughters went to Poly Prep, a very expensive school in Brooklyn. I grew up around there. It was always like an elite school. It's a beautiful campus. And my daughters went to great colleges and did well. They constantly asked you for money. So you're paying at the time $25,000 a year for high school. And they are constantly asking you for money. They're relentless.
Also being a celebrity, they must have asked you to do events, host this, auctioneer.
See,
do
that
this,
I didn't mind so much. I didn't mind so much that, you know, because, yeah, how much more you
fundraising?
You know, I'm not a multi-millionaire, so I'm happy to give. I gave them some money. I did game shows, charity, Jeopardy. Celebrity Jeopardy, you get paid. The other thing, what's the other show? After Jeopardy.
Pyramid? Wheel of Fortune.
Wheel of Fortune, you know, you get paid, and if you win, they give money to your charity. I gave them the money. I did numerous things to raise money. I did the auction with John Franco. His son went there, a great guy. We did the auction, raised $250,000. They're still unappreciative. Still unappreciative, to me anyway.
Really?
Still take advantage. John Bon Jovi's kid went there. John gave a concert, raised $1 million for them, or over. Did a concert at the time, I think it was American Airlines Theater, gave them the proceeds. Not enough for them. They just keep on fucking hammering you, and then they forget you. They're on to the next, you know, on to the next thing. So though my kids got a great education, they're still friends with a lot of people. I'm not a fan. They couldn't get they couldn't get a quarter out of me, you know.
Not anymore. Just aren't,
no, not a quarter. In college, they called me. We had lunch. I met them down at Tribeca Grill, me and my wife. I told them I'll have a vent for you. I'll do whatever I can in that way, but I'm not writing a check. I'm paying full freight. Listen, when I was in college, I grew up poor. I got financial aid. Now I'm paying full rate. Rack rate, and I'm fine with it. I have the money. Right. I'm fine with it. I'm paying for everything. I'm not trying to get anything. I'm okay with it, but now you want me to go above and beyond, and they kind of turn you out. Yeah. And they use that. They use the shit with your kid, you know? I mean, oh, I want my kid to have the best, and you know what I mean?
And he's doing that here. He's saying Meadow's doing so great. Her experience, she's, we love her, and is he, you know.
And I'm going to tell you this, too.
Bullshit.
She says, I talked to the professors. She's this, she's that. I think he's lying. I don't think he talked to the professors.
He says this about everybody, probably.
Yeah, and she says, oh, I'm so happy to hear that. Don't tell her. She'll get overconfident. He's lying. Because if she says, you know, Meadow, the dean said you really participate and you do this and you do that, you know.
She might say, I don't. But, yeah,
absolutely. She'll get overconfident. He says they sleep a lot. One question, why do they all sleep? He says they all do. I'll tell you another thing. You know, the SAT scores and all this stuff. A friend of mine, good friend, an attorney, his daughter can't get into a school. However, he does it for $100,000, $25,000 a year on top of the tuition, she could get in. Okay, an extra 25, whatever the tuition is.
As a donation or what?
As a donation. He'll give a donation. That was the deal. And she'll get into the school. She had bad.
But that's illegal, no?
She had bad SAT scores, right? Bad SAT scores. No, but it wasn't done that way. You know, it was like, well, how about if I be a good friend to the school, that kind of stuff. You know, you don't. This wasn't like what's going on with Lori Loughlin. They were flat out, you know, payola. That's not what this was. Okay, make a donation. She got into the school, a great student, just passed the bar. Just passed the bar.
Wow.
So, you know, wow. They didn't want to let her in over this, you know what I mean? They didn't want to
SATs,
let her in.
SATs, but they...
Correct. You know.
There was enough. Enough of a donation to, you know, overlook that.
You know, and what do you tell you? You're telling me all these Kennedys and all these kids get into Ivy Leagues and Brown and all these celebrity kids.
But
they're all fucking geniuses to get into Ivy League school. You know how hard that is?
Of course. You know, well, there's legacy families, alumni families, and all that comes into play. And a lot of that's money.
Yeah. Let's not bullshit here. The Bombancero house, Tony walks out with a baseball bat. He smashes a car window. And he honks the horn.
I think it's pissed off.
And it's very funny. She's got a Cadillac.
She's got a Cadillac, which really gets under his skin. Yeah. That really bothers him. That he's given money. She's asking for more money, kind of, to Camilla. The dog doesn't even look sick, which bothers him even more. And it's kind of interesting that this scene comes between the two scenes with the dean. Because it's about kind of shaking down subtle, you know, subtle ways of shaking down, getting more money. And you know, Tony doesn't fall for it, but Carmella certainly does.
Yeah, yeah. It's funny. He says, if you see Carmella, you see my wife, talk about oven cleaner, which is a great line. You know,
great
you
line,
see my wife talk about oven cleaner. Oh, the dog, he looks okay. It comes and it goes. She's flat out lying, trying to shake Tony down for more money. She's living pretty good. If you could afford a Cadillac, certainly not a necessity at all. He is pissed off. He's actually, here's this 6'1", 250, 60 pound guy. She's tiny, and he's actually pointing the bat at her.
Oh, yeah. And I think part of this is also the fish. I think it colored this period of time for him and his, you know, dealing with Angie and remembering Pussy. I think that it all kind of come together. And he's, you know, still mad the fact that his friend ratted him out to the feds.
You
don't get over that very easily.
Carmella and Dean Ross are having lunch. I spend about half my time with student affairs. This is how I spend the other half, fundraising. They're paid big money, these fundraisers, and even might get a piece of the action, like a bonus based on what they bring in.
And it's expected. You have to do this to keep that position, I'm sure.
Yeah, of course, then, you know. He says, we know what you gave at the high school.
Which I find that was very interesting that they share that information, the schools. That's probably true, I bet.
Yeah, well.
I don't doubt that.
I tell you, I think this is how it goes down. This school, whatever, high school, the kids are trying to get to Columbia. This guy knows that. There's a whole system. They're feeding. And he makes a call to the school. You know, the academic advisor, listen. The Sopranos, she's at Columbia. What kind, could you tell me what kind of dono they were? Easy.
Right.
That's easily done.
It's relationships. He talks about the wall. They're going to build a new building. This is the wall where the donors' names are inscribed. It's a $50,000 level. And this kind of refers to that scene, the book that Meadow was studying about this kind of capitalism, conspicuous consumption. And it's about ego in a lot of ways, having the name on there. Somehow this really appeals to Carmella. Almost as much as she thinks it's going to help her daughter, I think it also appeals to her.
Oh, yeah.
That social climbing thing that she, sure. You know, she's invested in.
You know, she also says 5,000. He said, okay, you know, they go, they're in the bedroom getting ready. She says, he says, I'll give you 5,000. That's it. I know all about extortion. She says 5,000 is a slap in the face to these people. The way Junior,
5,000, yeah.
The way Junior kind of worships Kennedy, she's kind of with the dean and this idea.
With the dean.
You know, yeah. That, you know, this is going to help Meadow. It's going to make her a better person, a better student, better standing in this incredible Ivy League college, you know.
It's also interesting the way he throws the money at kind of at her. It's a parallels, Christopher, with the shoes, dumping them, you know. It's kind of like, and he's throwing the money. It just reminded me a little bit of that scene, but this is, you know, kind of a very different context in their relationship. He's kind of throwing that money that's just like to get rid of her.
She says he's Italian. She says Jews. He says Jews with better food.
He assumed she was Jewish, yeah. And she said, no, he's Italian.
Well, Ross, you know, because of that, I guess. I don't know. I kind of like Jewish food. I love pastrami. I love that stuff.
Me too.
Yeah, I'm a big too. Jewish deli guy.
I used to love the Second Avenue Deli. They moved. Are they still open? It used to be down in the East Village over there on on Second Avenue, obviously. But I used to love that place.
I like Mill Basin Deli.
They moved uptown.
Did they?
Mill Basin Deli is good.
Mill Basin Deli in Brooklyn. Old school. Great.
Yeah.
Great. Doctor's office. Tony and Junior at Dr. Meta's office. He's talking. This is the second opinion. He suggests chemo.
Sloan Kettering, which is the best cancer hospital.
Best cancer doctor in the world. He says, you know, let's go to a tumor board. They'll pass their decision on what they should do next. Because he's saying if you take the chemo, you still may need surgery. So let's put it out there with a bunch of experts and let's see what the game plan is. And right. Kennedy
and
be Junior's there.
Junior's like, you don't get these maybes and possibilities with Kennedy. Kennedy. He doesn't like that. Junior don't like this guy.
No. It's zip, boom, boom, get it over with. And I understand that in a way. You're comfortable. You know what I mean? You're kind of comfortable. This guy, you feel confident with him. What do we got to go through all this shit? The hallway, he says, well, you know, what, you know, they talk about Kennedy. Tony says, let me ask you about this JFK worship of yours. What about Hoffa and the Teamsters? He says that was his brother.
Well, and yeah, Tony's like, you're making life and death decisions based on a man's name. And the Junior's like, that is not much to him talking about this. He's not impressed with Dr. Mater. Dr. Mater doesn't ring those bells and whistles like Dr. Kennedy does. It's not up Junior's alley at all. He's not so happy.
The Soprano house, Carmela's waiting in the driveway smoking a cigarette. The phone rings. It's Dr. Krakauer. Thanks for calling me back. She says, yes, I'd like an appointment. You know, she'll come in and see him. Tony comes out. So here she is smoking a cigarette. Edie used to smoke. In this episode, I believe you also smoke. And Sirico, I see smoke. Who no longer, none of you guys smoke anymore.
And Stevie used to smoke a lot.
Stevie used to be a big smoker.
Me, Sirico, at one time we would go through cartons. Me, Stevie Van Zandt, and Sirico. When we were together, we'd go through cartons on set. The prop guy couldn't keep up with it. Between the in the scene and off camera, it was crazy.
And then they gave you cigarettes to take home, right, everybody? You know, when we had those big scenes together with everybody, I remember sitting next to somebody. I mean, it drove me crazy. How much smoke? I mean, it just made me crazy. Tony comes out. He says, you know, this says pulp. He comes out with holding the orange juice. He's looking for his wife. Think about this. She's not in the house. He comes outside looking for her. He said, what are you smoking? He's got his bathrobe on with half a gallon of orange juice. He says, I want pulp. I want some pulp. I mean, she throws the phone at him, rightfully so.
Yeah, she just feels like this is what you care about. You don't care about the stuff that I care about. You come home late. You won't have dinner with me. You leave in the middle of dinner. We can't have a night alone. You get called into work. You won't do the donation like I wanted. You weren't there for lunch with the dean. But this, you really care about.
Care about pulp, you know, some pulp.
And she also has that slick lie when he comes out, when he's like, who are you talking to? She goes, the paving guy. I want to repave, goes, you know, really slick, right on the money there too.
Yeah. You know, she says, you give money to all these widows and Angie, and you won't give the money to college to protect Meadow. So she's asking him again for the money. He's not, you know, he says, I know too much about extortion, which obviously he does for a living. Here comes AJ. Her demeanor changes, got a big smile on his face. He's embarrassed, as a kid that age would. She hugs him. I missed you so much. What was he gone? 2-3 days, maybe?
Probably.
He only went to D.C.
3 days, yeah.
Of course, you know, they had, you know, PlayStation right in the room. You know, that was... That's why
the, one thing he brings up on the trip. He goes to Washington. The one thing he's most excited about, they had PlayStation.
Car wash.
Saw this or that or whatever.
Car wash. Christopher's talking with Tony. Came to my apartment in the middle of the night, and he embarrassed me in front of Adriana. He was sniffing her panties. Tony says, be a big boy and suck it up. But Tony doesn't like about the panties. The other stuff he doesn't care about.
It's over the top. And he says, Paulie can be a little quirky.
Yeah.
He's always been.
The understatement of the century. Tony slash Paulie can be quirky.
Tony slash Paulie can be quirky. I like that.
Hospital, the tumor board. Leading
That's
the way.
That's our producer, Eileen Landris, playing Dr. Lawrence. She was one of our main producers, and you know, kind of really ran the show over there.
Yeah, she ran the show
after the nuts and bolts of the production.
Yeah, after David, she was in charge of everything. She kept everything running smoothly. She's going to be a guest on our show, and she's got a whole lot to talk about. So I can't wait.
She also was a producer of Girls. She was there for that whole, you know.
Yeah. I also think she's in. I think she's in London, working. She's very good. I think she. You know what? I'm gonna ask her, but I think she started medical school or was gonna go to medical school herself.
She went to Brown University,
and she looks very comfortable here as an actress. Yeah. She's great. You know, it makes you wonder, you know, with the doctors here. Kennedy doesn't want to operate. He doesn't want someone breathing down his neck. And, you know, you always think that the doctors, you know, that this is what they do. They
they're worried about you, that they have your best interest in mind. It's not about their ego, right?
And we see it right here. You know, he's going to pass. He's not going to operate. Junior's house, you know. He's on the phone. Bacala's talking. I'll have him there. More chemo for Junior. He's going to start the chemo like Dr. Mehta says, because Kennedy does not want to operate anymore. Junior, he's looking around for Kennedy. Kennedy's not there. Nowhere to be found.
That's Tony Hale, who became the star, you know, one of the stars of Veep, won 2 Emmys, a supporting actor on a comedy. That is Tony Hale as the chemotherapy nurse there.
Tiny role here, but was certainly onto way bigger and better things and has done well for himself. He's a very funny, talented guy. Bada bing parking lot, Tony talks to Paulie. You go too easy on him. And Tony asks him, did you sniff her panties? You have to apologize.
And he says, as of the wedding day, anything that touches a pussy's off limits. After the wedding day.
And
he brings up something later with Christopher, you know, something interesting before and after a marriage, how it affects, you know, the sex life when Christopher comes out of the motel and he says, you're not even married and you're already dipping into whores.
Yeah. He's judging you there, right? Junior's in the bathroom vomiting. I remember this. You know, this bathroom wasn't part of the set. They built this. And it was like literally, that bathroom was like literally in the middle of the stage. Just that little
Junior's
L-shaped piece.
Bathroom.
Yeah, it wasn't
but
part of
it. But Junior's kitchen and living room, was that a set or was that a house?
That was a set.
Was that on the stage?
Yeah.
That was on the stage. Oh, really?
Yeah. The second, my first episode, that was a house in Newark where Junior falls. Remember, he falls in the shower and then Tony picks him up and all that. That was an actual house. Then they built it on the stage and this was a tiny L shape, just nothing, you know. I mean,
when they built it on the stage, it was to mimic what it really looked like in Newark. They followed it exactly, pretty much.
Not exactly.
Not exactly.
No.
But close.
But It's just funny. The bathroom, I remember this going, this is just like in the middle of, just middle of nowhere. Just this little L-shaped thing. Because on TV, it looks like it's a real bathroom.
Yeah.
They built a tiny set. He's throwing up in the bathroom. He sits on the couch. He says, I can't take this anymore. He tells him, Tony comes in, I can't take it anymore. I leave him messages. He's not answering my messages. I sent him cigars. He can't handle the chemo. Kennedy will not answer.
And Tony doesn't like that.
And then Bobby says, Bobby says, the doctors, they're not like they are on TV. Dr. Kildare, Dr. Casey, all the doctor shows, they're not
saying
like
elsewhere.
They care so much. They, doctors, it's like any other profession, some care more than others. Plumbers, teachers, actors.
But doctors, you expect
a lot from,
right? You expect, the one line when he comes out, Junior comes out of the bathroom, Tony says, it sounds like you were going at it pretty good in there. And Junior says, my pain is the source of your entertainment, which is actually, Caitlin Meadows' roommate has that line when she sees the homeless after the movie Freaks. She sees that movie and she says, people's pain is a source of entertainment. And this is something, if you think about it, you kind of see that with Livia. She laughs. She talks about laughing when Johnny falls down the stairs. She laughs when Tony falls down the stairs. Gloria, I think, too, that she, when we see Gloria's character, she talks to Melfi about, somebody laughing at her pain. It's a theme that comes up a lot during the course of the series. Pain as a source of entertainment. Other people's pain as a source of entertainment.
Well, doesn't David laugh? David laughs. He has that kind of sense of humor, doesn't he?
David has a great sense of humor. I mean, he laughs at a lot of silly stuff. I don't know if it's always at somebody's... Well, look, when you look at the old...
I don't mean at people.
Laurel and Hardy, the Three Stooges, all that stuff. People get... It's funny when people get hit in the face with something and get knocked down.
Yeah, no, I didn't mean in real life. I thought like on the show. Like, I remember, I don't know if you told me, in season 4, when I'm crying at the coffin, David was falling over laughing at me crying that my wife died. I'm not talking about in real life. Yeah, well, somebody told me that. He was hysterical. I'm not talking real life people's pain. I'm talking on the show.
It's just the gallows humor.
Yeah, on the show, he found that funny. So Tony gets the doctor's number. He leaves a message for Kennedy. Christopher
Tony's
leaves the
pissed off too. He does not like that. No.
Christopher leaves the hotel room with the hooker. Paulie drives up, get in the car. What's this, some new rule about who I fuck? And Paulie warns him. You go, complain it to the big man again. We're going to have a problem, my friend. What I did like here a lot, when Paulie's reaching back, Christopher doesn't know what he's reaching in the back seat for. Fucking Christopher's ready with the gun. He'll kill Paulie right there, and I like that.
He's got his gun on his ankle.
And he pulls it, and he's ready to fucking defend himself, and he'll kill him. And I kind of like that.
Yeah.
Instead of being all, scared, blah, 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 that's enough. Christopher's gone enough of this now, If I, Paulie's going to try to, hit me or something.
Who knows?
And he pulls out the Billy Bass again. It's playing YMCA.
And well, he's playing laugh. YMCA, and they bond over that. They have fun, and it's, apparently they originally had it playing Don't Worry, Be Happy, and Bobby McFerrin wouldn't allow us to use it on the show because he wasn't.
What's fucking Bobby McFerrin's beef? What's his fucking beef?
He didn't want that song being associated with, I guess, the violence of the show. Well, listen, YMCA is a much better song.
Yeah. Well, I saw Bobby McFerrin open for Bill Cosby, so he had no problem with Bill Cosby doing what he was doing.
Well, he might not have known what Bill Cosby was doing.
Well, fuck you, Bobby. How's that? Don't worry, go fuck yourself.
YMCA is a much better tune, I have to say. I think it's much better anyway. The golf course, what's funny is Dr. Kennedy's nickname is Jack, which was JFK's nickname as well. Mm-hmm. You know, his friends call him Jack.
Jack, gotcha.
Which is hilarious. It goes that far, right?
The golf course, great scene. Here comes Furio driving the golf cart. Tony has a gift for Dr. Kennedy. Federico does a great job of getting very close to him in the golf cart.
Very, yeah.
He really
very
drives
intimidating.
And they walk him back into the pond. He won't take the gift. He's arrogant at first, and he deflates. You literally see Kennedy, Sam McMurray deflate.
He shrinks. Yeah.
They threaten him. He smacks his hat off. Famous line: "There's a bee on your hat." He knocks the recorder into his into the pond. He says, "Treat my uncle with the respect he deserves. Answer his phone calls." Kennedy is scared. He's very scared.
He's scared, and he knows what this is. You know, there's no winning here. That's it. You know,
he's out of line. He's out of line. Now, this next scene is one of my favorite scenes in the entire series.
Me too.
Really, honestly,
yeah, it's really, really good.
Dr. Krakauer's office.
Carmela's Sully Boyer, who actually passed away right before this episode, a month before this episode aired. So this is one of his last roles, but you know him from, he played the bank manager, Mulvaney, in Dog Day Afternoon. He played the owner of the car wash in the movie Car Wash. He was in Panic in Needle Park, King of Marvin Gardens, The Gambler, Fort Apache, The Bronx. He's an actor studio guy. I got to meet him a few times when I was at the actor studio for a year.
He's terrific.
He was around. Terrific, terrific actor. And he brings so much of that old world wisdom to this scene.
So
it's
good.
Really beautiful.
Did you see the movie
and
Car Wash?
Edie's phenomenal in this.
Did you see the movie Car Wash? Franklin Ajayi, you know who that is?
Yes.
He was in Car Wash, the big afro.
Yeah.
Very, very funny stand-up. He worked for me in Vegas years ago. He was late, and I had to go up to his room to get him. I knocked on the door. He was naked playing the clarinet. That's a true story.
And that's why he was late.
I said, "Franklin, we need you downstairs." He said, "Okay." Swear to God. Completely naked. He's playing the clarinet. Came to the door.
He was a good clarinet player? He could play?
No, he was just learning. He was learning the clarinet, and he was completely naked. And he's really funny. Really funny. Like, so funny. And
Car Wash was, I think, the first movie that Joel Schumacher directed. Oh, no, he didn't direct it. I think he wrote it, actually.
Wow. George Carlin.
Joel Schumacher was a costume director. I think Joel Schumacher wrote Car Wash. I don't think he directed it.
Great movie. Also, you know, Mike Nichols was originally cast to play Dr. Krakauer. Somebody told us that on the show. But he decided the role wasn't for him. He didn't think he was going to do a good job. He had the role, went to the read-through, and decided not to do it.
I thought that was about Kupferberg, no?
I don't know. Maybe this also. I don't know.
Maybe both.
Look at that. She tells him, he's matter of fact, this guy. He's a no bullshit guy. You know that right from the beginning. I'm considering divorce.
And she has trouble dealing with that. She has trouble dealing with him. She's used to people being more, you know, deferential. Well, work it out, wishy-washy, Father Phil. And then you realize, well, Father Phil, they're probably donating money up the wazoo to the church.
Sure.
So he's not going to say, dump Tony. You know,
no,
it's very interesting. Yeah.
Father Phil's a bullshit artist. He's a good man. Well, I can't say that about a priest.
No, he is, though. It's funny. He's a bullshit artist.
Yeah, bullshit artist. I said I was considering divorce. He's a good man. He's a good father. You know, he's going, how can he be a good father? I mean, you're telling me he cheats. There's many women. She buries her head. She's saying he's a good man, a good father. He's a criminal. Organized crime. He says mafia. She breaks up when she hears it come from him. You know, she says, do you mind if I ask you, are you Jewish? And like, you know, like that matters. She's saying, well, Catholics, you know, she don't emphasized Catholics don't get divorced. He says, I've been married for 31 years. You know, she's talking about family, like pretty kind of a silly remark for sure. Like Jews, right. You know, people, Jewish people that don't care about their family as much as Catholics, right? She buries her head. His crimes are organized crimes. The mafia, she breaks apart. He calls her an accomplice. Leave him and go.
He calls her an accomplice, yeah. And she's trying to say, well, you know, I'm trying to, you know, he's trying to work. He's a good man. He's a good father. I'm trying to work with him. You know, I want to help him. I look the other way. And she's saying, you know, no, he's a depressed criminal prone to anger, serially unfaithful. And then he says, patients nowadays want to be excused from their predicament, from their responsibility because of childhood problems. She says, that's what psychiatry has become in America. Visit any shopping mall or ethnic pride parade. Basically saying people are not taking responsibility for their shit. They're just blaming it on their past.
Yeah.
And they're still assholes instead of like evolving.
My father never hugged me. My mother never right. did this. So they're going to be right. fucked they up blame. For the rest of your life because of right. that?
And they justify their bad behavior or justify their deficiencies by blaming their parents. And he's calling it like it is and saying, no, he's a criminal. He's evil. He's committed these horrible crimes. And you are, all right, if not an accomplice, an enabler.
Enabler.
Because you do his laundry and you cook him his food and you stand by him and you benefit from the blood money.
Yeah, he doesn't want to. He says he won't take money from her. Because it's blood money. I mean, he is, and she says, I thought you weren't supposed to be judgmental.
Right.
Now, you know me.
And
they call me Steve the Judgmental Bastard.
Well, I think you came up with that name yourself.
Well,
didn't you?
Well, you know, I did those bits for Leno. The Judgmental Bastard.
Which were
I
think very funny bits.
Yeah,
you would kind of basically judge a book by the cover, basically.
Correct.
That's basically what you would do.
And doesn't everyone
you're not
judge?
To do, right?
But do you think not everyone judges in one way or another? Come on.
Yeah, but you took it to another level on that show.
You know what? I judge, and I'm okay with that. I am okay with that. And she says, I thought you're not supposed to judge, you know, tells the psychiatrist. I'm okay with it. Steve, the judgmental bastard, I wear that. Monica proudly.
Well, right. He says, trust your instincts and leave him. She says, the priest said, try to work it out, help him be better, which is all bullshit. You know, like I said, Father Phil, I won't see, I guess I'd just pay you and leave. And she said, he says, I won't take your blood. I'm not taking your money. She goes, that's a new one. She goes, no, it's because it's blood money and he really doesn't want it. He brings up crime punishment. The best thing for your husband would be for him to go to jail and reflect on his crimes, read the book, Crime and Punishment, reflect on his crimes for 7 years in a cell. Maybe then he would be redeemed.
She talks
about getting divorced.
He's pretty harsh.
I got it divorced. I got to get a lawyer. I got to get an apartment. We're going to have child support. You know, she's like, she's just avoiding facing the truth. Now, I heard Robin Green wrote this scene. Based on Robin Green's brother's a psychiatrist, and I heard that Robin Green's brother had a patient who was maybe two patients who were molesting kids.
Oh,
and he recommended they read Crime and Punishment and turn themselves in.
And they did
that. I don't know.
But aren't you supposed to, as a psychiatrist, even something like that? If you know a crime is committed, you have to go to the
maybe
authorities.
He was good. Maybe it was like either you turn yourself in, or I'm going to turn you. You know, you're better off if you turn yourself in than if I do it. It probably reflects better on your case as well.
I sure hope I sure hope so.
That's what I heard. I don't know if that's 100% true. I did hear that.
She but says,
basically, he's saying, you know, it's a great scene, and it really, he
so
presents
good.
Her very honestly. Yeah.
She
wants
well,
to hear the wishy-washy bullshit, yeah. self-help, yeah. everybody's okay, and everybody's a good person, really, and you'll work it out. And he just says, no, he's got to pay for his crimes.
Well,
and if
also,
you stand by him, you're going to pay.
And she also says, yeah, I got child support and got to get an apartment. She's going down the laundry right. list of what needs to be done. And, you know, he ain't having it. He's pretty harsh. He just met her. Pretty fucking harsh. It's a great, great scene. He was great.
Yeah.
He was great in this.
Really great. One thing you can never say is that you haven't been told.
Correct.
He leaves her with that.
Great. Good stuff, man. Really good stuff. And you know what? You're together so long, it would not be easy for her. Get attorneys, this big mob boss, the house, the kids, it's not so easy. Some people just stay for years and years and years. It's a matter of convenience. It's like, oh,
she's in deep.
I don't have the fucking energy to leave him or her. Fuck it.
And she loves him on some levels too. She certainly does still love him. I think, you know.
We're in the hospital. Junior's getting chemo. Dr. Kennedy walks in. Are you taking good care of this young man? Oh, Junior's ecstatic. He feels better already. You know,
yeah.
Is this shit going to work? Are we going to go back to the operating room? He gives him his home phone number. He was complaining until he sees Kennedy, then he perks up. Junior's ecstatic here. Kennedy knows better.
Yeah.
He does the right thing. Because he doesn't want a visit from them. The next time, they would probably beat the shit out of him. I doubt if they would kill him.
Oh, yeah, no.
Probably break
that.
His hands
They'd
so
hurt
he couldn't
him.
Do surgery. Yeah.
They'd time. Hurt him or really do something bad, without a doubt.
Soprano house, Tony arrives home. Carmela's sleeping on the couch. He asks if she's sick. Everyone else sleeps all day. I thought I might as well, too. He comes home in the middle of the afternoon. You're depressed. The dean called. I put us down for the $50,000. And Tony doesn't go crazy. He doesn't jump up. He says, I'll go as high as 10. That's it.
10.
I already told him 50. And she said, Tony says, are you depressed? She says, in the division of labor around here, that's your job. Great line.
Right. And he says, you go see the therapist. She goes, that's rich. You suggest I go see a shrink. You know, and he's, I'll still go with you to yours. Blood money again, 50 grand. She figures, I guess Carmela's making the deal. If I'm going to deal with blood money, at least make it benefit my kids. Benefit Meadow. Make sure she's in good with the dean, in good with the college. You know, she's gonna, and then he says, well, why don't we go out for dinner? She goes upstairs and like the cycle continues.
It's great. She's wearing that blanket. It's a great scene. Her from behind.
And the song comes back. Niels Lofgren's song, Black
Book. Great song.
Comes on.
Great episode, man. Great episode.
It certainly is. Some fantastic acting. You know, Sully Boyer, Edie Falco, Jim Gandolfini, Dominic.
Dominic's great.
Great stuff.
Yeah.
All right. It is time for the Talking Sopranos Ask Me Anything segment. The winner of our AMA best question of the week is Joe from Fargo, North Dakota. We will be sending Joe a pair of Bose headphones.
Joe is in the witness protection program, I think. What the
in
fuck
Fargo?
Are you doing in Fargo? Joe asks, major characters got whacked regularly on The Sopranos. You two beat the odds and were on the show for a long time. Going into the final season, what were your thoughts about the fate of your characters? And what was it like when you actually found out the final outcome of these characters that you had played for such a long time?
Well, I knew at least a year before what was going to happen to Chris. I think Christopher got to the next to last episode. I mean, he died in that Heidi and Kennedy episode, which was right before the finale, I think.
I died. Bobby died in the Blue Comet. That was
which one was the which next one was the one Christopher one. Died in? I don't remember.
I don't know.
But Andy. I knew what was going to happen a year before. I knew it was going to be towards the end in the last bunch of episodes. So, you know, David told me way before, and I thought it was a great idea. I thought it made a lot of sense. You know, I was glad that I made it to the last season, the last few episodes. It was, you know, for me, it wasn't, like I said, I don't remember being worried all the time that Christopher was going to die or be written off the show.
Well, because your character was different. They needed you. You were basically the second, after Jim and Edie, you were the third lead. They needed you. I mean, that would be a huge hole for many reasons.
Yeah, it was a fun, it was a colorful character.
Yeah.
But what about you? When did you know?
I found out, you know, in, well, first of all, I didn't, once I signed on for the last nine, which they call it season six, but for the last season seven, once I signed on, Chris died
in Kennedy and Heidi. Heidi.
What number was
that? And that was episode 83. So what was, how many episodes, was it 85 or 86?
86.
I think it was 85.
86. And the last one was nine. So I think in episode six, maybe. 86 episodes.
Okay. What was the name of the Blue Comet was the one
Blue
you
Comet.
Died in.
Yeah, but you know, once I signed on for the last group of nine, I kind of felt at that point, hey, I made it this far.
It was all gravy.
One, yeah. I'm getting paid. Number two, the show's coming to an end, so whatever best for the show. I mean,
right.
at that
well,
point.
Well, we both got paid all produced.
All
that
produced,
means
so you get paid.
No matter, yeah.
You know, even if you died in that first episode, yeah. So that was not the main thing, but a big thing. And you made it to the next to last episode. That was pretty good. And I, once he told me, you know, when David told me, came to my apartment and told me, I mean, I didn't feel bad. It was like, okay, I'm going to make it almost to the end. And it was a great run. I mean, I was on the show.
And we're all going to wrap it up after that, yeah.
Yeah, it's over. I mean, you know, they killed me off in a great way. It was a great shot, a great scene. So that was
memorable.
A big thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, that was a big thing, too. If you faded away, that was a little slap in the face. I mean, they gave me
if you just drifted off and you didn't have closure or that kind of thing. Yeah.
You know, this was a great send-off, and I was okay with it. I mean, negotiations were tough. I was one of the last ones to sign on.
For the last two seasons?
For the last
season. Because those were negotiated at once.
No. For the last nine, no. The last
nine. Last
nine
we renegotiated.
For
huh?
me, it was renegotiation. I was one of the last ones. It wasn't, you know, I thought I wasn't. Though I was lucky to be there, I thought I wasn't being treated fairly. I held out and it worked out. I remember David calling me and said, are you happy? And when it was all over, and I said, absolutely. And I thanked him, you know, for all his help and everything. And that was it, you know. So there you have it. Joe, enjoy your headset. Joe from Fargo, North Dakota. You're probably the only guy in Fargo with a Bose headset, so headphones, so enjoy. Let's go back to the episode.
Now, why would you say that? Why would you say
well,
he's
I didn't
the
think
only...
it's that. I don't think Fargo, you think, have you been to
I
Fargo?
There might be tons of people with Bose headsets in Fargo. We don't know.
Well, if you're in from Fargo and you have a Bose headphones, please let us know. Okay? You're very fucking touchy today. Very touchy.
I'm touchy, yeah.
Thanks for listening. And remember, new episodes are released every Monday. Now, come on. Subscribe to the Talking Sopranos podcast on YouTube, Apple Music, Spotify, Amazon, or wherever you get your podcasts. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram and like us on Facebook. Right now, you can get official Talking Sopranos merchandise on the TalkingSopranos.com or through our YouTube channel.
Our executive producer is Jeff Sussman. Producer is Andy Verderam. Our music was composed and performed by Elijah Amiton. You can hear more of Elijah's music and the band Zopa, which Elijah and I play in together, by clicking the links at TalkingSopranos.com. Our fantastic production crew includes Eric Desi, Bobby Hutch, Frank McKay, Ty Verderam, and Sierra Schirripa. Talking Sopranos is a Pod Jams production.
This was a great episode. It was a pleasure. Yeah. Spending a couple hours with you today.
Really good one. Same. It always is. Highlight of my week.
And I will see you next week.
See ya.